You know, YouTube. The tube of you.
The tubes. Hello, welcome to Screen Source Episode 2, your show for television news, reviews, and trailers. We're starting a little bit late today. I'm very sorry, guys. Yeah.
It's okay.
You guys are busy, busy people.
I don't accept your apology.
God, I'm pouring my heart out.
Keep pouring.
Keep pouring. All right. I am Dylan. To my left here is Jessica. How
Hi.
Are you?
I'm doing good. Thanks.
To my immediate right is Jason.
Are you going to ask me how
nope.
I am?
Nope. And to my far right is Kevin. Hi. How are you, Kevin? You were nice to me.
I'm good.
Okay, good. I'm really excited. I'm really excited. There's a lot of new trailers, a lot of new news, mm-hmm. a lot of new things in particular that we all kind of compiled for you guys. So let's get started. I'm going to take this mouse from you, and we'll go to our first topic. Patty Jenkins fires back. So who picked the Wonder Woman topic? I think we probably all saw this news.
Yeah, yep. No, I saw it.
And I don't have my notes ready, so if you want to take the lead, at least at the beginning of this.
So it started when James Cameron made some comments about Wonder Woman, and I'm not 100% sure what he said.
Yeah, we're going to figure it out right now.
He said something along the lines of it was sexist or something.
Right, because she was... like attractive, the character,
right.
And yeah,
we should Which probably have our facts straight.
Probably.
I'm gonna look it up, guys.
Yeah,
I was doing tech. You guys could have done a little bit of the news.
Well, we thought we were prepared.
We
but,
did.
That's right. I'll
anyway, James Cameron said some things about Wonder Woman mm-hmm. because he's James Cameron, and that's what he likes to do. Is
Variety. Patty Jenkins fires back over James Cameron. At James Cameron over Wonder Woman criticism. Wonder Woman director Patty Jenkins on Thursday night hit back at James Cameron, who in a recent interview called the superhero film.
I need to interrupt.
Yes.
So I can see the title, like the stuff on the PowerPoint.
Yeah, I'm just decided to leave it. It's easier. Did you get that? It's okay. We're all good. All right. In a tweet, she said James Cameron's inability to understand what Wonder Woman is or stands for to women all over the world is unsurprising. As though he is a great filmmaker, he is not a woman. And so, yeah, what do you guys think about this?
So what did he say exactly? What
he said she's an objectified icon and it's just male Hollywood doing the same old thing. I'm not saying I didn't like the movie to me. I'm not saying I didn't like the movie. To me, it's a step backwards. So he thinks they were objectifying...
Women.
But why? Why is she objectified?
That is a good question.
He didn't say.
I mean, like, what's the difference between, like, Batman's pecs?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, you're playing a superhero, like...
It's
going to
be grandiose.
There's a certain amount of objectification that's going to happen.
Yeah, it's going to be grandiose. It's going to be over the top. It's not going to be... what a normal person is going to look like. It's
right.
It's meant to be an idealized version of a human.
Yeah, and I get it. Like, she wears a pretty sexy costume, but why is that a problem?
But it's not like it's like a bikini or anything, you know,
no.
Or like, I think it's perfectly fine. I don't agree with that. It's objectified more so than any other superhero.
No, yeah, it's no Princess Leia bikini from the 70s.
Yeah,
that's mm-hmm. true. And it's also how it's filmed too. Like it was the she and the other women in the movie weren't filmed in an ogling kind of way.
Mm-hmm. Right. It
wasn't
like the script
like a lot of
that
like
we read.
Skirt shots.
No,
or anything, you know,
it was more.
Just,
it wasn't how Joss Whedon wanted it.
No.
Mm. And actually,
which we'll talk about today.
There was one part in particular where she lands, and they like show that her thighs are like jiggling when she lands. But mm-hmm. that was supposed to be like an empowering thing, like
I don't remember
that she has some like
jiggling thighs.
I feel like
some
that
meat on her bones.
Purposeful,
you know? No,
it was
purposefully
done.
I don't know, but that's what I read, and I did enjoy that because I think it showed that she's like not, you know.
Right.
Mm-hmm. As really, really skinny person. She has like, you know, some muscle and some.
Yeah.
And he called his remarks sexist.
His remarks sexist.
Yes.
You mean James Cameron's remarks?
Yeah.
I think he's just really misguided. Maybe his heart's in the right place where he's wanting to try to make a feminist critique, but
right.
he's well, not yeah, the person to make that critique.
Yeah, I agree.
Do you, so I'd be interested, when you say he's not the person to make the critique, I'd be interested to hear what you or anybody would have to say if Jenkins made it so we all kind of agreed maybe that it was like sexist or objectifying. But then Jenkins is the director, so does she get final say? And also she's a woman. And, you know, it's just interesting coming from mm-hmm. a, because it's a man saying your film is sexist. You're a female director, and also the lead in the movie is female. So I don't know. It's not what we regularly expect from other people, which is saying, which it's usually the other way around, obviously. A woman saying that a man's film might be sexist.
Yes. Sorry, I lost your point.
I would say James Cameron's like a notorious just asshole.
Mm-hmm. Is he?
Yeah, like I think many people who've worked with him have just he's just proven himself to be sort of
abrasive.
Yeah, like pretty abrasive.
Michael
like
Bay abrasive. Michael Bray. Asshole?
Yeah, I think like in that vein. I mean, I don't know if he's as much of like a
abrasive.
A bro.
Yeah, a bro as Bay is. Bay bro. But, I mean, I know that he's just, he's not the
doesn't have a good reputation.
Yeah, from people who've worked with him, I know that he can be a little contrarian, and I'm guessing this might be where it's coming from. Mm-hmm. And he seems to be a little, he always seems to get sensitive when he's not the one getting the news about the groundbreaking, doing the groundbreaking movies.
Right.
Yeah. I don't know.
I sort of feel like, you're right. Like, I think he might be jealous a bit that his movie's not the one in the limelight. And also, I tend to not really respect necessarily what he's saying because he's a male director, and I don't know.
I mean, you can say, Alien, right? That was...
Mm-hmm.
He did Aliens.
He did Aliens, I suppose. Ridley Scott. Yeah, Ridley mm-hmm. Scott. Never mind then. I retract that comment because that character is pretty.
Oh my god, like she's wearing strong. Underwear and a wife beater, right? I mean,
at the end of
mm-hmm. yeah, so that's pretty objectified.
I agree with Kevin here. That his heart's in the right place, maybe misguided though.
Yep,
sure.
Is mm-hmm. that what you said?
Kind of
by putting words in your mouth.
No, that was basically what mm-hmm. I said.
All right, topic two, Suspiria.
Oh, so they're it was. Just a news article that caught my eye. Have any of you seen Suspiria?
No clue what this is.
Sounds intriguing.
You all need to. It's a Dario Argento film, I think from like the late 70s, early 80s.
Uh-huh.
Italian auteur, director, a horror movie, like a slasher film in like an early slasher film. And it's just like, it's just so wonderful. There's a band named Goblin. Have you heard of the band Goblin? They write all the music, and it's all like just synth horror.
John Carpenter.
Yeah, but like having more fun. It's more. It's this is one of my favorite horror movies, and they're remastering it, putting into 4K, whatever Ooh. That means. I don't know what that's. But you can tell if you go and you look up the articles, you can see. I think this clip shot is from the first cut. But they remastered and it just looks, it's already a beautiful film. Just beautifully, horrifying.
Is this a shot from the film?
Yeah, this is, Suspiria. Yeah. And it's all, so the main plot of Suspiria is like, it's a dance school or girls' school for dancing. So you have all these like female dancers and then, there's this weird witch man, woman, creature thing that starts just slaughtering all of the girls and hunting them down, and it's a great soundtrack, and they're remastering it. I'm looking
like
forward
great.
To
really
seeing
cool
it.
Plot.
Yeah,
that's crazy upgrade. Because when did this film come out?
Yeah, like I would say late '70s or
late '70s up into modern 4K.
Yeah, and it looks beautiful. The movie itself is already beautiful, but from the pictures I've seen, it looks stunning. I highly recommend. Halloween's coming up. Put Suspiria on your list of movies to watch. Mm, and as like the that. Halloween season.
Do any of you have a 4K TV?
No.
Nope.
No, yeah, I don't either. I have five televisions in the house, and none of them are 4K.
Yeah, I think they're doing like a tour of the movie. It's not out yet in 4K.
Okay.
They're touring it around.
Got it. Got
Obviously,
it.
Obviously, it's not coming to Albuquerque. It's nothing ever does.
That's true.
I know. Darn.
All right, sounds like fun.
Cool.
Jay and Silent Bob reboot.
Yeah. So, I was just looking up news articles, and I've never really gotten into. Not that I've. I haven't really watched a lot of Jay and Silent Bob stuff, films. But the one that I did watch was one with
Clerks
Ben Affleck. Two? I've watched Clerks 2. I've watched the one with Ben Affleck where he's...
That's the third one in the film. That is...
Chasing Amy.
Chasing Amy,
I've watched Chasing Amy, and I've also watched Dogma.
Okay.
So those are the ones that I have watched, and I've enjoyed all of them. I think they're really good. And I think this should be interesting. I don't exactly know, like, reboot. Does it mean that they're going to use the same characters? It says that, actually, Kevin Smith's still going to be directing. He's been itching to jump back into his... into this, and he originally planned to do this with Clerks 3, but the threequel fell through when one of the leads dropped out. And then he said that third time is a charm because he's gearing up to revisit the duo at the center of his shared universe, Jay and Silent Bob. So he's going to what is he going to do? They just celebrated their 16th anniversary of Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back. So so basically he's going to reboot this. And I don't know whether or not it's going to be them two again or if it's going to be new actors, but he is going to be directing.
There's no way they would choose new actors.
They can't, right? I mean
they can.
They can, but it would be
They're not going to do that.
It would kind of not be true to the
Yeah, I mean it would be
that'd be funny if it was an origin story.
Yeah, I mean, I'm wondering if that's what it is, and I wouldn't be surprised. And you could probably find some actors to play these characters, but I don't know if I'd want to, you know? I want to see Jay and Silent Bob just grow old, and I can't wait to see these people with gray hair doing these roles.
I think they have a podcast that's like Jay and Silent Bob Get Old or something on
this
podcast network.
Yeah.
That's funny.
So, yeah, I'm incredibly excited. I love this series. I don't think there's a movie in it that I dislike. Mallrats is my favorite one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you guys have favorites?
I've never seen a Kevin Smith movie.
Not one.
I've
not
seen a lot of Kevin Smith movies, and I don't know if I actually like them.
Really?
I like the idea of them. I think more than the actual sitting down and watching them. I don't. It's been a while since I've watched one, and I would be interested to see what I think of it now. But yeah, I don't know. He's always kind of they're a little bit hard. I feel like, I don't know, there's something, I can't put my finger on it. There's something that's a little bit hard for me about them.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
I don't know what it is.
I don't know if it's your kind of movie, Kevin.
Why do you say that?
Because he has shares your name.
Okay.
And you're just,
so when I think about, when I think about our like senses of humor, mine's a little bit more like you called the other day bro-ish.
I think you said bro-ish and I just agree.
Yeah, these movies are very bro-ish.
Yeah, well, they lean more towards that and the poopy and the farts.
And the stoner.
And the stoner.
Stuff.
Stone
yeah,
bro-ish.
And I just don't peg you as that type of person.
Mm.
I mean,
stoner, bro.
Stoner, bro.
I have many facets, so
I
don't know.
Like you could enjoy it. I think you might like Chasing Amy.
Mm-hmm.
And you might like Dogma.
Okay.
You might enjoy certain parts of it. Yeah, I think you would.
So those would be your two recommendations from...
Yeah, I think you'd like them.
Mm-hmm. I think the most popular of the bunch, you know, is Clerks, his first movie.
Mm-hmm.
And then maybe Dogma.
Okay.
Mm.
Yeah.
Wait, so you said this is like a series or it's just like...
Well, these are characters that are in all the movies and then they had their own standalone movie. Mm-hmm. Silent Bob Strike Back, right? Correct. That was the only one. And I think till this day, that's the only one that they have starred in exclusively.
Yeah.
So they're kind of like in the background of other movies or
Correct.
Side characters.
Yeah, yeah, they're always it's all the same universe, if you will. But if they're not all Jay and Silent Bob, they just happen to be in some of them. You know? They'll be the B story, C story.
And Ben Affleck and Matt Damon are in a lot of their movies.
Okay.
Yeah. Because
they're like really good friends with them. So.
And I Jersey like Girl.
Them. Oh, yeah. Jersey Girl's good. It's very cute.
Is that the same universe?
I think so.
I think so. I'm pretty sure. Yeah.
Cool.
That's another one you'd like, Kevin.
I'll check it out.
Yeah.
All right. Next. Mega Man movie. The guys that produced Catfish
are
going to write and direct the film. Do you guys know what Mega Man is?
Yes. Of course.
Yeah.
I don't know anything.
What does it look like to you?
It looks like an anime superhero.
Yes, that's exactly.
You're both wrong. It is not an anime. Well, okay, it's not anime, but it is a superhero.
Okay.
He is a video game character.
Big eyes, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It's Japanese.
Okay.
It's a Japanese video game.
Okay.
I'm sure at some point they turned it into an anime, but it's based off of a video game series. I never watched Catfish, so I don't know what to expect.
Catfish, the like reality TV show,
or Catfish the movie?
First.
It was a movie, but.
Where's that coming from?
Was it a documentary?
Oh, I know what it's coming from.
Never mind. Is it a movie? Is that what you said?
The Catfish movie. Is it it's the movie about the people who get catfished or the guy who gets catfished.
I think that's where the expression came from. Or which was that the thing before?
I don't know, actually, which came first.
It's just a weird transition from like doing that to doing a Mega Man movie.
Yeah.
Like, what?
It's a pretty drastic change.
It's not at all in the same genre.
Well, it's been several years since Catfish came out. What have they done in the meantime?
Yeah, that's a good question. It's it's a duo. They write together and they produce together, apparently. Okay. I
Wasn't
don't know
a lot
done.
Of like controversy about that movie too, that a lot of it was staged or untrue and they had just kind of created it for the sake of filming it.
Now somebody told me Orion might be able to chime in here because I think he knows a lot about that movie, but I don't think it was a documentary so much as like a they made it look like a documentary.
I see. Okay.
Yeah. But anyways, yeah, I'm excited. I love Mega Man.
Mega Man's great.
Yeah, he's a great video game character. People are saying this is gonna ride off the back of the Castlevania animated series on Netflix, which just came out. Which apparently is doing pretty well. Okay. So we're hoping to see more actual good video game content make its way to film and to screen because it has notoriously been awful.
So is this going to stay a cartoon or is it going to be actually like a
It does not
live
say
action?
Live action.
Okay.
I'm sorry. It does. It does say live action.
Oh.
Holy crap. So one of the things about Mega Man is that he has an arm that looks like a cannon and he shoots stuff,
cannon ions,
I don't know, something like that. And so I'm wildly interested to see how this turns out.
What studio is it? Like a
probably
not Disney.
Oh, it won't be Disney. No. According to Hollywood Reporter, Henry Joost and Ariel Schulman of Catfish fame are in talks with Chernin Entertainment, and Masioka to write and direct this film. Chernin Entertainment. Let's see what they've done. Let's look at their other filmography. Rise of the Planet of the Apes.
Oh.
Exodus, Spy, Snatched. Done a lot of good stuff. Mega Man to be announced.
All
so
right.
We don't actually have a year for it, apparently, but.
Okay.
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah. It should be fun.
That's pretty cool.
All right. Next topic. You want to take this one?
Oh, I don't. All I know about this is they're going to create a Joker origin story that is Warner Brothers in DC, so I assume it's going to be in the same shared DC universe as well as that's going. And it's Scorsese is producing, and from what I read, it's supposed to be in the vein of a 1980s Scorsese film, a la Taxi Driver. That's the movie that was referenced in the article I read. About like what
the tone
of the movie, that it's not so much like a superhero flick, or it's supposed to be like a gritty 80s
how
like
he came
Scorsese
to be
origin story. Yeah, and Todd Phillips is a great director.
Yes. What did he do?
Todd Phillips did, I want to say, I'm Not There. What was the movie? Let's
look at Todd. Do you guys like Taxi Driver?
Yes.
I haven't seen it. Have I seen it?
I don't know if you have. I think you'd remember. He has the famous lines where he's standing in front of the mirror and he's like, what does he say? You looking at me?
You looking at me? You looking at me? Yeah.
Yeah.
It's Robert De Niro.
I misspoke. Yes. Todd Phillips is not, I'm Not There. It's old that school, The Hangover. I was thinking of a different director. I don't know how I feel about this now. But
no, I know who you were thinking.
I like Scorsese.
Carol, right?
Yes. Todd. His name is Todd something.
Todd something. Hold on.
I like Scorsese. I mean, I don't know. It seems interesting.
Come on, Todd.
And I really...
Todd Haynes. Sorry. Yeah.
Not Todd Haynes. Todd Haynes would have been a better choice.
That would have been a weird
Todd Phillips is like comedic. Yeah. Bro-ish.
It's weird.
Yeah, sounds like a bro thing that I may just not be into. Yeah, especially if Jared Leto is attached.
This
no
is
offense.
His first comic book film. Yeah, no. How do we feel
Jared
about Scorsese
Leto,
moving
not.
Over into that?
Well, it's supposed to be very not very comic book. That I think is the point that they're why they grabbed Scorsese is I think that they're trying to I don't know what DC's doing. I think that they're trying to like they're hoping that people are going to get bored with the Marvel structure, which I think people are.
Fair point, yeah.
But so they're trying to I think get the Scorsese types to come and take over. But
I agree about Jared Leto, Kevin. I don't want him to be
I do not think he's
involved.
Attached to
good.
This.
That's okay. good.
It's like maybe like an 18-year-old Joker.
Awesome. Yeah. That'd be better.
Well, did anybody see Jared Leto's
I know I
Jared Leto's
no.
last movie?
No.
Yeah, I didn't watch it either. I just heard so many bad things that I heard it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would just skip.
Yeah.
So that's exactly what I did.
Yeah.
All right. M. Night Shyamalan. Was this my topic or your topic?
It's
or
probably yours.
Okay. M. Night Shyamalan is moving on to his third film in a trilogy, right? So the first one of this trilogy was Unbreakable.
Unbreakable, mm-hmm. Yeah.
The second one was his most recent film.
Split. Which you didn't realize was sort of a sequel-ish
yeah,
until
the
end.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay. So that's kind of a little bit of a spoiler, I guess. And now he's talking about Glass, and they have an official... plot synopsis for Glass. Here's what we know about the film that'll close out the trilogy. We talked a little bit about Shyamalan last week. Unless you've been living under a rock, you know that M. Night Shyamalan, Shyamalan Split, which looks like it earned $250,000. That's not bad. Was actually something of a surprise sequel to Unbreakable. You also know that Shyamalan's next project, Glass, will bring this unexpected trilogy to a close and bring together all of the major players. Today we got the first plot synopsis, so I'll just read a little bit of it. From Unbreakable, Bruce Willis returns as David Dunn, as does Samuel L. Jackson as Elijah Price, known as, also by his pseudonym, Mr. Glass. Yeah. Joining from Split are James McAvoy, reprising his role as Kevin Wendell Crumb, and the multiple identities who reside within, and Anya Taylor-Joy, who we talked about last week, as Casey Cook, the only cat to survive an encounter with the Beast. This was a lot of spoilers in there. Following the conclusion of Split and Glass, following the conclusion of Split, Glass finds Dunn pursuing Crumb's superhuman figure of the Beast in a series of escalating encounters, while the shadowy presence of Price emerges as an orchestrator who holds secrets critical to both men. So who saw Unbreakable and who saw Split?
Seen both.
I've only seen Unbreakable.
Yeah, me too. I've only seen Unbreakable. We missed Split, even though it looked amazing. Yeah.
You know how it ends now, but...
So what do you think about this?
I'm excited. Like I said last week, I think M. Night Shyamalan's getting back to his sort of B-movie roots.
Okay.
Mm. That's what he's good at.
Yeah.
I like this idea of, like, he's making series, like a series of films now. He's never done this before, as far as I understand.
I don't think he has. Go ahead.
I'd say I'm down because I think that, Unbreakable is my favorite movie of his that he's made. I felt like it was just, like, such just a grounded, subtle superhero film in a way that I feel like we have directors that keep that are still trying to make that movie, and he already did it well before the superhero era took off, and I think it's beautiful. It was a great movie, and Split was sort of in that vein, I suppose. Just very I like his movies are just so focused, and they've got a very specific approach. And I think that I've liked them both. I was very pleased to find out that we were bringing back Bruce Willis's Unbreakable character. And okay. this with Samuel Jackson back in the mix, I'm in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we're excited. This is going to be fun.
Yeah, I think it'll be good.
I'm a big M. Night Shyamalan fan. I know a lot of people hate some of the things he's done, but I like most of his movies. I really like... I'm a big fan of Signs and Lady in the Water, and
The Village is my favorite.
The Village is so great. Love The Village. Yep. So, definitely.
All right.
Does that lead into our next? No, it doesn't.
Nope. 100-Year-Old Man adaptation. Will Ferrell will star in this adaptation. The comedian will also produce. He's teaming with CBS Films to adapt the best-selling novel, The 100-Year-Old Man Who Climbed Out the Window and Disappeared. And he is attached to star and produce it with Adam McKay and Jessica Elbaum.
I don't know Jessica
The Elbaum. Trio Gary Sanchez Productions. Mm-hmm. Set to write this. The gentleman that writes for Narcos, Jason George, is set to write the screenplay. And a screenplay that translates Jonasson's 2012 book. CBS Films picked up the book's rights. For some reason, I feel like this was done before. There was a movie or a TV series.
So is this going to be a more serious?
Okay, so here's like a little bit of a synopsis. It centers on a man who, on the night of his 100th birthday, escapes from his nursing home and hits the road. Well, the ensuing inadvertent adventure involving criminals, a bag of cash, and an elephant happens.
Is he the 100-year-old man?
That's my guess. So they're going to put him in makeup. Oh, that was another problem I had last week when we were talking about the second movie of the Back to the Future trilogy. They didn't hire old men instead or women. Instead, they put everybody in makeup.
So good.
It looked awful.
Yeah, it does.
It looks
But it's
so
supposed to be.
Bad.
It's campy. It's supposed to be. I think people can do amazing things with makeup that they couldn't do 20 years ago, 30 years ago.
Mm-hmm. So Will Ferrell's going to look
He'll look
old.
Awesome.
I think they should have hired an actual 100-year-old man.
I do agree, though, yeah.
To play this role.
I disagree.
It's hard enough to be a 100-year-old man in this industry. And then when 50-year-olds are taking all your roles.
Yeah,
I think
true.
If you've ever been on a movie set, there's a lot of standing around. And I don't think we should subject a 100-year-old person to that.
Like, he thinks that's abuse. I kind
maybe
of
not
I, 100, oh, that's such a hard
Kirk
thing.
Is Douglas still around? Because
I think he is.
I think he would.
This is being described as darkly comedic, much like that of Forrest Gump. Tom Hanks Forrest Gump.
I would say I'm really excited. I think anything Adam McKay and Will Ferrell do together is going to be funny.
Mm-hmm.
And Adam McKay has kind of branched out a little bit, and he's.
What's the last thing he's done?
Was that The Big Short?
The Big Short. I thought he made something last year. He's making something this year that is in that vein.
Okay.
It's interesting to see these two get back together.
I liked the sort of serious movie that Will Ferrell did. Gosh, I do not remember what it was called.
Stranger Than Fiction?
Yes.
Yes, I love that movie.
I liked
that
it.
That was
a
strange movie.
I disagree.
You didn't like that movie?
I don't want to see Will Ferrell do anything that's not ridiculous.
He's still funny.
Well,
it
I will.
Just like
I will admit, he's. I love Anchorman and like Talladega Nights and all his ridiculous movies that he's done. So I agree. I even watched the one where he was like a novella movie in Spanish and he like spoke
good.
Spanish.
So good.
So good.
Nobody watched that one.
I watched it.
I
don't
know. Yeah.
What was that movie called?
God, I don't remember.
Casa de mi something.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah, that sounds right. Oh God, it was so
Dylan
funny.
And I were
had
just
a whole
like
movie
dying.
In Spanish, yeah.
I was crying.
It was
so
really,
insane.
Really.
I hadn't really heard anything about that one because I wasn't sure if it was.
Yeah.
Watch it.
So okay, I'll have to watch it.
All right, next.
Yay. So I just stumbled upon this week. So Steven Soderbergh, who directed this week's movie, which we're going to talk about later, Logan Lucky, is producing a limited series coming to Netflix. It's a Western, but I'm mostly excited because it stars Michelle Dockery, who plays Lady Mary on Downton Abbey.
Oh, I love her.
Yeah, she's awesome. And so she's going to be, I don't know, a frontiers woman, and one of the pictures was her firing a gun. It just looks like it'll be a fun.
This movie was filmed in New Mexico.
In Santa Fe.
In Santa Fe. Oh, I know many people who are in it. I coached personally two kids that were supposed to play. Who's that? What's that guy? Jeff Daniels. His kids.
They look the same.
And the kids got fired because they were too rambunctious. But yeah, no, I've heard good things. There was multiple Westerns being filmed in New Mexico around the time this one was, and this is the one that made it actually to, the other ones aren't going through. This one is, so I assume
cool.
That means it's good.
I hope so, yeah. It's got a good cast. Jeff Daniels, who else was in it? That Jack O'Connell or something. He's a young actor, up and coming. Mm-hmm.
Cool.
Kinda guy.
I like Jeff Daniels. So
yeah, I mean, just those two are enough for me to be in.
Yeah, definitely. And I like Steven Soderbergh, so.
Yeah. It just
cool.
Seems like an all-around.
Well,
and I enjoy Westerns.
Soderbergh's last film was Logan Lucky.
Yeah, and like he supposedly retired from making film
a
few years ago, and then he came back and made more films. So.
Cool.
Awesome.
All right. Feminist?
Feminist?
Who is the question about?
The girl, obviously.
Okay. I'm
going
to say no.
So Joss Whedon, breaking news. His ex-wife wrote an essay that she opened to the public and said he is not who he pretends to be. Kay Cole writes in The Wrap that Whedon had numerous affairs after 16-year marriage. He uses marriage as a shield, quote, so no one would question his relationship with other women or scrutinize his writing or any as anything other than feminist, end quote. She was diagnosed with PTSD after Whedon confessed his infidelities. The representative for Whedon tells The Wrap that Cole's account includes inaccuracies and misrepresentations, but adds on that Whedon isn't commenting out of concern for his children and out of respect for his ex-wife. This was kind of like big news last week. I kept seeing it everywhere.
Yeah.
Also in the news, Joss Whedon is working on the Justice League.
Yeah, he took over directing duties after, what's his name? Zack Snyder had to step down.
Right.
He had a family tragedy or something.
Right, so he's still, I mean, I don't know how this is going to affect his career.
Yeah. This is, I mean, I have often, I'm a fan of Joss Whedon.
Yeah, I think
work.
We all are.
Mm.
We all have, yeah.
But this is obviously like a different side that we haven't seen before.
It's
and
personal
it's just
life.
Like, how does that affect how I view him, and should it affect?
Yeah. I mean, those are all good questions to ask.
The charges, he's not a feminist, or he can't be a feminist because he had an affair.
Multiple affairs. Their entire.
Well,
marriage.
I guess I would open that question up first. Do you think that disqualifies you from being a feminist?
Nope.
If you are
not at all.
No,
I
just think it means that you have issues. Like, if you are going into a relationship and saying, I'm going to be monogamous with you, and then you're having affairs, I think that's just a personal issue.
I think it's a personal issue.
The story was like, well, like, you should see Joss Whedon out in public. He's, like, slapping, you know, asses and, like,
right.
You know, calling, like, women, like, toots and, you know, and stuff. I'd be
right.
Like, okay, yeah, that sounds like he's probably not a feminist.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know the details. Again, I don't have all the information to make an accurate opinion, but...
Yeah, I mean, as far as what we know, it isn't something like who fought last night, who's beaten the shit out of like every one of his ex-wives.
Mayweather.
Yeah, it isn't that, in which case I'd say probably not a feminist if you're just beating the crap out of your defenseless wives and things like that. I mean, it seems like they had a bad relationship, they broke up, and then people are saying, you know, he's not a feminist anymore. He's written all these TV shows and films that are
like Buffy.
Very woman positive.
Well, I would say... Do we consider Buffy? Do you think that's a strong role for?
Yeah, no, it's
women?
It's an iconic series, and Buffy is a feminist icon. That doesn't change. I mean,
just because of this news,
it's one of those things where, and this is not exactly the same situation, but like when Casey Affleck won Best Actor last year, just I mean, there had been allegations about his behavior on the set of a film where he. Been like harassing one of these female producers. It's like, can you separate the art from the artist, which I think you should. It is a little bit.
It's so difficult for me to answer that question because I personally can separate the art from the artist.
Yeah,
and I feel like there are multiple musicians in specific that, like, John Lennon and David Bowie, who've done terrible things and are not necessarily, but they were also advocates for a lot of things, and so that I support. And so I can do that, but I don't necessarily agree that it's a healthy thing to do that.
So one of the other things too with all that information is like, okay, now why do I go out and support this person?
Mm-hmm.
You know, do I put money in their pockets?
I guess like it depends on what the offense is. Sure. And there are certain things that are worse than other things. Mm-hmm, obviously, mm-hmm. Like there's no accusations of physical abuse or,
right.
You know, like, you know, you have like the Bill Cosby like mm-hmm. level, and like mm-hmm. on this, like on the spectrum, it seems like if the accusation is only like he wasn't faithful to me, like I would say that's not like ideal, but like at the same time, like I don't know what's going on in their marriage.
Yeah,
right. I don't know.
It's
like,
obviously,
and
less
I'd say
than
that's probably
on the lower end.
Pretty common in Hollywood. I mean, people don't stay together a lot
everywhere.
In Hollywood. Just doesn't happen. So I don't know that. And I also feel like when you have a breakup or a bad divorce, you kind of want to like get revenge on that person or make them look bad, and so maybe that's what her motive was. And so we don't know. I think you're right, Jason. We don't know the whole story, and so
mm-hmm.
we can't really judge it without knowing more details. Yeah.
All right. Feminist? Yeah, sure.
I mean, ultimately, I don't think it's really going to affect his career. I think he'll be fine.
No.
And
yeah. The news has already changed back to what is he doing with Justice League.
Exactly.
Yeah. All right. District 9's Neil Blomkamp wants to direct an Iron Man movie.
No.
This isn't huge news.
No, it's just kind of cool.
Did you say no?
Cool.
I said no.
I said no.
Wait. What's going on here?
Chappie.
I hate Neil Blomkamp so much. I think he is a terrible director who lucked in. I think District 9 is a bad movie.
Whoa.
And I think that it's got some cool things about it.
Sure.
But I think narratively, it is bad.
I kind of agree with that.
Wow.
I think it was like had enough good ideas in it for people to be like, oh, this is brilliant. If you really like look at it and like take it apart, I don't think it's that great. And I don't think any of the movies he's made since then have been.
So he made Elysium,
which
and
I didn't
then
see
Chappie.
To be fair, but Chappie, I did watch on an airplane.
Elysium. And it was. Wasn't terrible, but it wasn't great.
Wow, I've never actually met like Blomkamp naysayers. I'm a like a big Blomkamp fan.
Yeah,
I love his films.
I like District 9 a lot.
Yes, I've seen them all.
I really like.
I will say the
people
the bad guy in Chappie wasn't great.
The people
Hugh
in
Jackman.
Well, and also we really like what are they called?
Diane Ward. Yeah.
They were I really like Diane Ward.
They were the white
South
guy
African.
And his girlfriend.
Okay.
I mean, everybody,
like
almost everybody.
Rapper
in his
and
African.
This like weird girl.
They were in Chappie.
In Chappie. Yeah.
They're
no,
really
I
cool.
Remember them.
Yeah.
I
but,
didn't like them.
But yeah, I definitely think.
<They're not>
yeah, I definitely like Neil Blomkamp, and I think that District 9 is a good movie, and I think that he could probably. I don't know. I like the Iron Man movies a lot. I think, but I think Robert Downey's like the driving force in that. So
yeah.
I don't know.
He was going to do an Alien movie a while back.
Yeah, it actually says here he was going to do Alien 5.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that fell through.
And I'm very happy it fell through.
I think, don't be surprised, Blomkamp fans, if you're finding that happens a lot more with him. Because I think he had a lot of buzz after District 9.
Yeah.
And it seemed like Elysium. A lesbian.
A lesbian.
Elysium. Like, it didn't. It wasn't as critically acclaimed. And then Chappie also got pretty rough. I mean, I didn't see it, but it got pretty rough.
I think
years.
They were
still
okay.
Working with big producers, big directors. I mean,
but
he's a director.
I think that,
he's
like,
working with big name
he
actors.
He was on his way to getting that Alien movie, and I think that they pulled it from him after Chappie came out because I think.
Yeah.
Again, I haven't seen Chappie.
Chappie. Okay, I was on a 14-hour flight when I watched Chappie, so I was not in, like.
The best of moods.
Yeah.
Sure.
But I just found that movie to be like so like morally confusing. Like the people who are supposedly the good guys are also like horrible, awful,
but that's
abusive,
okay. I like the idea of something being morally confusing.
Yeah, but it wasn't like confusing in a way that was like intentional. It was, I don't think he knew what his morals, I don't think he knew what he was trying to say with that movie.
Okay.
And in the end, it was like, I don't know, maybe I need to see it again when I'm not.
His most recent work says he did a short film with Sigourney Weaver called Fire Base, and a third starring Dakota Fanning. Anyways, this isn't huge news because it was just a Twitter interaction. A fan asked him, "What film or character would you like to take a crack at the MCU?" And he responded with his choice, Iron Man.
I don't really like the fact that he's like putting it out there that he wants to do, like join these huge franchises, and then like using the buzz to like get that. I don't know. It's just
you
like
think it was very intentional that he went.
Well,
because
he did that with
that
Alien too.
Him.
It was like before he like. Before he got hired to do it, he was like out there like campaigning to do that. I don't know. That rubs me the wrong way for some reason.
His first actually big feature film fell through, and that's why District 9 got made. District 9 and was actually based off of a short film that I also thought was really good. The film that District 9 was supposed to be all the production and the money and everything was going towards was the Halo film, which is based off of the video game franchise. There was a fight between Fox and another company that was part of the distribution or something, so it didn't fall through. And who produced District 9? It was God damn it! That's on my DVD over there. Is it a Blu-ray? It's a Blu-ray. It's on the right. It's behind my purple monster.
Peter Jackson.
Thank you, Orion.
Yeah. Oh, do you still need this?
No. Yeah, so Peter Jackson was like, you know what? Let's do something out of that short film that you made. That's how District 9 got made. Anyways, I guess I can see from you guys already, not excited about him being a part of Iron Man if it were to ever happen. My guess is that it won't.
I think Blomkamp, and feel free to tell me I'm wrong. Many people have on this issue.
Mm-hmm. What's that?
I feel like he knows what he's doing technically, and I think a lot of times, I think that's why he got District 9, is he proved that he knew how to make CGI look good.
CGI is amazing.
And there was a lot of really good CGI in District 9 and had a very low budget. And, like, honestly, like, a lot of producers, they see that and they go, oh, great. That means that you'll, like, be able to make a movie for not that much money that'll look good for me. And sci-fi makes a lot. Sci-fi and horror both are money makers. But I think narratively, I don't trust him very much.
Don't trust him, huh? Interesting.
I don't think he's a good writer. Or a director. Anyway, I can go on, but I won't.
All right.
I agree.
Okay, so where do I find this? Okay, so the next one.
All right, so we are getting a Mulan live action movie. Mm-hmm. We're getting, as you all know, Disney's like been coming out with all these live action. Mm-hmm. Movies that were classic movies like Beauty and the Beast and Cinderella. I haven't been super impressed with any of them as of yet. I thought Beauty and the Beast was okay. I thought Cinderella was okay.
What was the one? Who's the bad person?
Oh, Maleficent. I did not like.
I thought it was awful.
I thought it was really bad.
I didn't see that.
Yeah, so I don't know. I think this could be interesting depending on who they get to play the actors in the movie. I really, really hope, really, really hope that they stay true to the ethnicity of the characters. I feel like they've been like kind of like in Ghost in a Shell, they had Scarlett Johansson play a character that's supposed to be a Japanese character.
Not
it's
Disney
like,
connected, though. I don't know.
No, but I mean, like,
mistake.
I don't know. I don't know.
I would say this is, of all the movies, I feel like this would be a tough one to not, to, I feel like,
Yeah.
Because like with the,
you would hope.
Like Doctor Strange, right? Like, and even like the Ghost in the Shell, there's nothing that like necessarily says they have to be one race or another.
Mm-hmm.
But the plot of Mulan, it's been a while, is what she's like the savior of.
She joins
the Chinese army
in her father's place by disguising herself as a man,
mm-hmm.
and then they defeat the Huns.
Yeah,
and so they have a really good time.
It would be. This is just This is an easy putt, really Disney. Time. This is an easy putt.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just cast Asian actors.
Hopefully. And one important thing that I wanted to note about this is that Alex Graves, who has done, he's a director who's done episodes of House of Cards, Homeland, and Game of Thrones, is going to be working on this.
That's
so,
the name.
So that'll be cool, I think. If yeah. And I don't know how they're going to do the dragon and like what they're going to do.
Would it be Eddie Murphy doing the voice of
Eddie Murphy?
God, that'd be cool.
I guess the voice for the original Mulan.
I thought it was Chris Tucker.
No,
Eddie Murphy
is the is
oh, he
Mushu.
Is. Okay.
Yeah, Chris Tucker, did he do another Disney film?
I think he did. I could be wrong.
Apparently, the voice for Mulan is Ming-Na Wen. That was from the 1998 film, and she's an Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. right now.
Okay, yeah. Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that was the voice of Mulan.
Yeah, I didn't know either. Yeah, cool. I've just seen trailers for Agents. I actually didn't watch it.
I've seen a few episodes.
But, yeah, I guess the news here is that their production starts in January of next year, 2018. They're filming in China, New Zealand, and Australia so far. They're pushing release to 2019. That makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
And they're thinking November or December of 2019. So I don't know. I honestly have zero expectations or low expectations, rather, for any of these live action reboots. I don't care about them.
I think this one could be good. Yeah. I think the issue with...
Which ones have been good?
I like Cinderella.
I did like Cinderella.
I think it was okay.
Has been that so many of the old classic Disney movies, especially like Cinderella and Sleeping Beauty, are not... They don't translate well to modern times.
Yes.
And so with Cinderella, I think they really like had to work hard to try to present it in a way that wasn't sexist.
Rewrite that script.
Mm-hmm. And I think they pulled it off for the most part.
Yeah.
But, I mean, Mulan is a more recent Disney movie. It came out in, like, 96 or something. And it obviously already is very feminist and has a positive, empowering message. So I think as long as they just make good action sequences and keep that strong feminist...
Yeah, I think the message is great in this film. And it's, like, recent enough that... It doesn't seem to have problems.
Yeah, like no, I don't think anybody has any issues with Mulan. Is
No. Mulan, it's one of the best Disney films.
I love
films.
It.
It's so good. It's the music's great too. I love.
Yeah, and
have they been using music in these?
Only in Beauty and the Beast so far.
Okay.
They're not going to do a musical in this one, I don't think.
Okay, that's probably for the best.
Yeah.
I don't know. I really like the music in Mulan. I'm.
Why don't you think they're going to use music?
That's what I read in an article, that they're not going to, it's not going to be a musical, but I think that could change depending on who they get.
Are they doing music for Aladdin?
Oh yeah, they're doing Aladdin.
I believe
Aladdin.
So.
Good question.
Yeah.
I met the woman who spilled the beans on who's directing the film. Who's it, Guy Ritchie? Who's directing that?
Guy Ritchie.
Is he doing Aladdin?
Yeah, I think that's
what
it is. Yeah.
Yeah, and it was like an accidental leak.
And it's two like no-name actors that are like...
Yeah.
Coming up now.
Did they cast the genie?
Yes.
Yep.
Do you want to guess who it is?
Oh my gosh.
I know who it is.
Surprised.
I don't know how you're going to feel about it.
I don't. Is it.
It's Will Smith.
Oh, I have. I did hear that. Yeah. Okay. Okay. No.
We'll see.
Interesting. I mean, Will Smith did grow up with me. I love that show.
Fresh Prince of Bel-Air.
That's
true.
After that, I don't know.
We'll see.
Maybe he'll pull it off. I don't know. He hasn't. I don't feel like he's done anything good lately.
He has a lot of character though, which is what
rich.
The original one had.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So.
Oh, Robin
too
Williams.
Rich, is that what he said?
Nobody
what
can do anything like Robin
Williams.
What was
that movie he did recently? It came out like late last year.
Concussion.
No.
The one where he.
Collateral Beauty or something.
Yes.
Which I didn't see, but I heard it was just like laughably bad.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, the trailers were awful.
And
yeah,
I mean, they
it looked
they
bad.
Had so many like. Big name
good
actors
in
it.
He's
like,
been on
how
a
do
role
you all sign on to something? So,
yeah, he's been on a roll of doing bad.
It could have been the editing, you know. Who knows?
I think it was just the script. It sounded like. Anyway.
All right.
Last. I think this is the last one. Star Wars 8 characters to be revealed. Star Wars fans will reveal a new character from the December's Last Jedi during the augmented reality event as part of the Force Friday 2 festivities. Mm-hmm. In just about a week, the first wave of episode 8 products will hit store shelves, so people will be able to see all the toys and who's going to be in the movie. Force Friday is something of an unofficial holiday, unlike that of May the 4th. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, it's just that we're not huge news either. We're going to see stuff soon.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Is really all
we're gonna get to like know if you get this app, you'll get to figure out like what characters are gonna be new in the series.
Yeah, they're using the app as the augmented reality.
Have some like inside scoop, I guess, is what they're saying.
I wish they wouldn't do that. Like,
you're not
gonna see the movie. I don't know. I try not to like overload on.
Yeah, but what about the people that do enjoy that stuff?
Okay, I mean, I guess it's fair. It's just, but then it ends up being like. Everyone finds out about it.
Mm.
Oh, I see.
Because everybody's like, "Oh my god, I just found out." Blah blah blah.
Like BB-8, you know how?
Have you seen the new little creatures that keep showing up on your feed?
Yeah, yeah, little blue guys. I just want. I'm already sold on this movie.
Of course.
I don't need to be sold anymore.
Yeah.
I just wish that they would.
Yeah.
Let there be some surprises.
Yeah. I do like how they on Force Friday they like sometimes will come out with a new trailer or something. That's kind of cool. But I agree. I think maybe. Too many spoilers.
Yeah.
You have any cares?
No.
All right. All right. Coming soon. Now with Post Tomatoes, this was last week, so maybe not coming soon. I can change that. But what we do here every week is we do a Post Tomatoes, and then we do new releases with pre-tomatoes. And what's the idea behind this?
The idea is it's a fun way for us to guess what the critics might think of any given movie on any given week. And then we can check and see how good our movie barometers are. And the person who's closest gets to feel good about themselves for getting
10 minutes.
Do you have the real scores? Did you write them down in a Post-it note or something?
So the real scores.
They're not on there, I don't think.
Oh, I wrote them down on that.
They're in the docs, but it's in the Post-it. Okay. Can one of you guys get those the Post-it notes?
I can pull up the doc.
Okay, that's fine. All right. So we did. These were the releases last week. It wasn't a huge week in film, as you will also see in this upcoming week. Mm-hmm. But Leap. Still don't know who produced that because I don't think any of us watched any of these movies. These were our guesses: 38% from Jess, 64, 57, and 22. What was the actual score?
It was 37%.
Wow, Jessica was 1% off.
Wow,
but you went over. So by
it's not Price is Right rules.
Is this Price is Right rules or what?
Sorry.
Terminator 2. This is the Judgment Day 3D remake that was released in theaters this past weekend. Jessica, 93. Myself, 95, 93, and 82. What was the actual score?
So the 3D version got 100%.
100%. Wow. I think it's only out of, like, I think Scott said something like a dozen critical.
I see.
The original is at 93%.
Okay.
So it went up.
Okay.
Okay.
7%.
Yeah, must be good 3D.
Got the right answer for the original, but Dylan.
And so did I,
So I was closest. Yeah. Woo! I did something.
Cool.
Good job.
Birth of a Dragon, the Bruce Lee film. That's Jessica at 31. I'm at 40, 17, and 12. What was the actual score, Kevin?
27.
27. Wow. The winner goes to Jessica.
Wow. Good job, Jessica. Jessica wins.
Yeah.
2 out of 3 went to you.
Nice.
Yeah.
We were pretty close, guys. We I think we got the general.
We got the consensus of,
Yeah.
Pretty
cool.
Close.
Good.
All right. Now for our next guesses for upcoming films with pre-tomatoes. This weekend, My Cousin Rachel with Daphne du Maurier. Is that how you say it?
Isn't that Rachel Weisz?
Yeah.
Why does Daphne du Maurier?
I think
that's
maybe that's
who
the
wrote the novel.
Got it.
Oh, so that's one of those.
Now a major picture. So that okay, yeah. Rachel Weisz and Sam Coughlin.
Oh, from Hunger Games.
Hunger Games.
Yeah.
Okay. Baywatch comes out this weekend. They've been hyping this one up all summer.
I thought it already came out.
Yeah.
May 25th. What the hell? I don't know.
I think it comes out on DVD.
DVD, that's probably what it was. Mm-hmm. God damn it. And then Killing Hasselhoff. This is just...
What?
Yeah, I put this together pretty late, guys. Sorry about that. Whatever. I don't care about any of this.
My Cousin Rachel looks like it could be interesting.
Yeah.
Did you watch the trailer?
Yeah.
Okay.
I like Rachel Weisz, so I feel like I could...
It's like a gothic.
Down with that one.
What are we thinking for that
Taylor?
One? Let's go down
I'm
the line and start with Jessica.
Go with... Oh... and guys back there producing, can you write this down?
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
So
go ahead.
My Cousin Rachel. I'm going to go 85.
Right.
79.
I'm going to say 65.
Ooh.
I'm going to go in the middle of you two and say 74.
This 75. Does feel like very Price is Right-ish.
Yeah.
Maybe we should just do Price is Right. This is Price is Right this hit.
And then Baywatch.
The DVD release.
The DVD release.
100%.
Baywatch, I'm going to give like a 20%.
I mean, there's an actual score for this that we could look at now.
I'm thinking somewhere around 50.
Just guess. Really? I'm going to say it's a 85.
I think you got like an 8%.
No, really?
I think I'm pretty sure.
Ooh, that bad, Kevin? What'd you guess again?
An instant tomatoes. 50.
Killing just Hasselhoff. God, this looks awful.
Oh boy, yeah.
Ken Jeong, what are you doing?
Ken Jeong is just kind of he's just
show?
Taking anything.
Did you watch a trailer for his show?
Yeah, I'm gonna give that
Doctor something.
Oh, it's like a sitcom.
It's a sitcom. The trailers look so bad. I feel so
Killing
bad.
Hasselhoff. Don't I'm gonna give it a 27%.
Don't hassle the Hoff.
Yeah, 20.
Don't hassle. I'm gonna say 55%.
Four.
Wow.
Just four.
This reminds me of what just the title itself reminds me of Keanu. Because it's the only other film where like there's the actor's name is in the title.
But
there's
I
not
really
very
like
much
Keanu
of that.
Keanu
though.
Was
no,
about
Keanu
the,
was fun.
Keanu Reeves
the cat.
Is in Keanu.
He's the cat's voice.
Yeah, he's the cat.
He's the voice.
Oh really?
The cat has a voice? Mm-hmm. Oh, I didn't know that.
It's like
did you watch it?
5 minutes.
No.
It's fun.
I have the score for Baywatch.
What is it?
It's 19%.
Wow.
So.
Okay.
That's crazy.
Yeah, that
That's
movie
remarkably
just.
I think I guessed 20, right?
Yeah. You're really good at this.
God, Jess.
I'm pretty sure Dwayne Johnson was very confused by the low ratings that it was getting when Baywatch actually came out. And there was a lot, he didn't understand. He thought it was going to get, a lot of good, positive reviews.
Which is weird.
Well, yeah. I mean, he does well in most everything he does. Yeah. So I guess he's just not used to.
No, that he thought he was gonna get those Fast Furious numbers.
Zach Offerman, does he have gold medals and then a 40?
Yeah.
Gold medals and a 40.
I mean, come on, how is that not an 80% movie?
I know, right?
All right. Also coming out this week, twice as hard as the first time. This is Goon, the last of the Enforcers. Apparently, I think Orion said he may have seen it, or at least that the first one actually is kind of cultish. People enjoyed the film a lot. I don't know. I don't know anything about this. Heal the Living, don't know anything about it. Queen of Spain, I'm pretty sure I watched a trailer for that.
Okay. I love Penelope Cruz.
Did Goon already come out? It says in theaters March 2017.
Jesus Christ. Come on, Dylan. This is awful. Maybe somebody else should put these PowerPoints together. I got a lot to do over here, guys. Nobody looked up news.
Trust. Queen of Spain.
Yeah, I had a hard time finding new releases for this week. I looked on a lot of websites and stuff, and I could only find movies. I could not find hardly any TV shows.
Yeah, we barely have any on here. That Vault,
The End of Summer, everybody's back.
Inconceivable, Little Evil comes out next week. We're watching a trailer for that one.
Oh,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. I feel like you put Little Evil on that. No,
I put it on.
Oh, you put it on there. Okay. Comedy, dark comedy. Comedy horror, something like that?
It's like a comedy horror. You'll see.
Okay.
Is it a movie or a series?
It's a movie, I'm pretty sure. Mm-hmm.
So it's The Omen, but funny?
Yes. Maybe? You'll see. We got this. The Vault has James Franco. Who else is in there?
I see an Eastwood.
The girl from Orange is the New Black. I always forget her name. Oh, Manning. Manning.
Emma Stone.
Yeah, I mean, that's quite a poster.
Say Emma Stone is in it?
That looks like Emma Stone.
It's not, though, but it looks like her. It does look like her.
An Inconceivable. That Gina Gershon, Nicolas Cage.
Yeah,
Fate
another
Dunaway
Cage film.
Dunaways and
it kind of looks like one of those. It kind of looks like one of those psychosexual thrillers, Inconceivable.
I would say that it's probably going to be really good.
Yeah?
Hey, Nicolas Cage I don't see his the movies he makes, but they look. He looks like he's having fun in them.
That's like, true. He always looks like. I feel like he always gives on.
I had 10%. I had a friend who say, "Yeah, this is." I had a friend who made a really good point. He was like, "You know, like Anthony Hopkins was in like freaking Thor, and it was very obvious that he didn't give a shit. Like he was just farting that performance in, and it's like."
Yeah.
Nicolas Cage, it doesn't matter if he's in like the biggest movie of the year or in the crappiest movie of the year. Yeah. Mm. He always gives 110%.
I love that.
Yeah. Oh. And I love it. I love Nicolas Cage.
Did I talk about this last week? I feel like I talk about it all the time. There was an episode of Community where Abed takes a class and it's like the title of the class is Nicolas Cage the best actor of all time or the worst actor of all time?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
He's both.
Mm-hmm.
Narco season 4.
Ooh.
That show's still going.
Surface. E-Surface. I don't know. Oh, the Surface, probably. I don't know why it's cut off on the sides.
E-Surface.
It's a robot surfer. E-Surface.
Yeah, yeah. The Surface, I believe. I think it's a documentary on surfing or this gentleman. Mm. And then Final Fantasy 14, Dad of Lights.
I can't wait for Dad of Lights.
Dad of Lights. It looks like a father playing
I think it's Dad
video
of Light.
Games with his son. Dad of Light.
Yeah.
I've actually seen it like Daddies of Lights. Or something like that too. I think it's bad translation, probably.
Sure, sure.
It's about a video game. One of my favorite video game of all time is Final Fantasy X, Final Fantasy 14. Apparently, there's a film connected to it now. It looks like it's going to be something about like maybe documentary style, the father connecting with his son.
Okay.
That's cool.
That's sweet.
Have you guys watched Narcos?
Nope.
No, but I've heard good things.
It's pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You excited for season 4?
I'll watch it. I've watched the other seasons. Is it season? I think it's season 3.
3? Okay, yeah, you're right. I'm sorry.
Because the first two were post Pablo Escobar now, though, which is interesting.
Okay.
Because the show's in uncharted territory.
Interesting.
So, I'll miss
the actor.
There's
no business like blow business is the tagline.
And he's great. I forget his name.
From Game of Thrones.
Yeah, he played
that guy's from Game of Thrones?
Yeah, he was the Viper, the Red Viper.
Mm.
He was Tyrion's...
Champion.
Oh, yeah. He was cool. He's cool. All like ninja-like.
Yeah, he's
gonna from
be
Dorne, right?
Yeah, he's from Dorne. He's going to be in the new Kingsman movie.
He's really good. He's,
cool.
He's
oh,
quite
right.
good
coming
in Game of Thrones.
Soon. Yeah. I saw a poster for it in the theater.
Excited.
Did you
quite good in Narcos.
I did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought it was fun. I thought I hated Samuel Jackson. It was awful.
Because he had a lisp.
Oh, that lisp. God damn it. All right, what are you watching? So, I don't even know who this is. I think this is... Oh, this is
Jon
you
Snow
you
and Jorah
down.
Mormont.
So this is all I know about what you've watched this week.
This is literally all I've watched.
This is all you watched. That's why you didn't put anything down.
Other than Downton Abbey, what we talked about that last week.
A lot of people saying this might be the worst season of Game of Thrones.
I think that's fair.
And maybe even one of the worst episodes of Game of Thrones this past week.
I think that's also fair.
Wow, that's crazy. I just like... It's so hard for me to say that they've done anything wrong. I just love this series so much.
I can
it's
say
the best
that.
Show on television, right?
A
we
lot.
All agree to that?
No.
No.
What's the best show on television?
Right now. Like
right
at
now.
This
Twin Peaks.
Yeah. I don't mean ever. I meant now.
Oh, like currently on
currently,
television right
yes.
now. Oh, shit. I'm not watching a lot of current things right now.
Okay. Okay. Really what about, high. What did you say?
Yeah, Twin like, Peaks.
Twin Peaks? Okay. Okay. I got to watch that.
I hear great things about
that. Yeah. I mean, I would say Game of Thrones in general to me can be, it can just really slog.
Okay.
And sometimes it's which is this past episode was the opposite of this problem, but sometimes it's just like they're like in the next episode of Game of Thrones Arya like talks to so and so and then it's just like she talks to him and then you're like all right like but then they always find a way to like move the plot forward and in this most recent episode it just really they really just kind of ditched a lot of the realism that they had worked so hard and slogged so long to.
I'll touch on the point, but I just want to say I think like next this maybe next to like Black Mirror for me. This
yeah,
might be
Black
the best
Mirror's
show,
freaking
like,
great.
Currently still running. A lot of people had problems with the continuity and the time jump. I don't care. I don't like. Who cares?
I mean, I can understand. Yeah, like we're getting to the end. You need to speed things up a little bit. I don't like how the characters are just behaving stupidly.
Behaving stupidly.
Yes.
How so? Who are we talking about? Talking about Arya? Are we talking about Sansa? Are we talking about
Arya mostly?
Okay.
I feel like she's being played. But then Jason pointed out maybe it's just like a
maybe
like
she's
a long,
not being played.
Yeah.
Long game or whatever the expression is, mm-hmm. where she's actually the one manipulating mm-hmm. things. And I hope that's the case, because if it's not, then I'm just
gonna
annoyed.
Be pissed.
It is fun to like, yeah, watch this unfold because there's mm-hmm. something going on between the three of them,
yeah.
right? And we don't know who's winning, who's on top right now. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's something to be saying with the writing. Like, there's too little being shown, too little being said. But mm-hmm. I don't know. It's a fun B story, I think.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, we'll see how it plays out. What I find interesting about what's happening right now is, like, you like all the characters, you think you care about all the characters, but it's not until they start, like, you know, bumping against each other and
mm-hmm.
that you realize who you really care about.
Sure.
So, like, I love Arya, I love Sansa, but when the two of them are, like, at odds, I'm Team Sansa all the way, I realize.
Oh, yeah, me too.
I'm on Team Arya.
I'm Team Arya.
No.
Because I love Arya mm-hmm. as a character. I just yeah. think she's badass.
No. No, Arya's cool. I like Arya. I feel like her journey the past couple seasons has kind of been a little... Like, she went to assassin school.
Oh, I changed my mind.
And then she, like, dropped
yeah.
out.
I forgot about all that. That's way better.
No, it's not.
I'm changing teams. 3-1.
I'm trying to, like, make reasons why you shouldn't support her.
You just
her.
Convinced me to support her.
Assassin school.
But,
yeah.
but in the Game of Thrones, though, who do you want to win?
Like, all of it?
Yeah.
Seriously.
Yeah. Of course you want Lannister.
Yeah.
Of course.
Sweet. I'm Team White Walker. It's just as awful.
Cersei's the most interesting character
I
on the show.
I want Daenerys.
The
Ice
Dragon is the most interesting character on the show.
And like the typical like I ship Jon Snow and Daenerys getting together and like taking over.
The little king.
You want the little
king
girl?
King Tyrion.
She's like 9 years old?
No.
Oh, okay. No.
Oh, King Tyrion. That would be great.
King Tyrion.
I thought you were talking about the Lord.
King Tyrion
Lord.
This season has been not good. Did I say King Tyrion? Tyrion, this season has not been good for him.
I know.
He's made a lot of mistakes.
Yeah.
He's
trying,
getting his ass
though.
Chewed out right yeah. now. She's not happy with him.
I don't know if anyone, other than Cersei, no one's really had a very good season.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
kind of
a
like, point.
That's yeah, a it's like, you know, and then there's one more season.
Well, I mean, they're making slow, but they're making incremental steps. Like Jon Snow is at least like he's getting what he wants. Nothing's really gone opposite for
Jon Snow keeps rushing into battles that he knows he can't win, and then being rescued by one of the female characters. And he
but
needs
that's
to
kind of
no,
what
he got
he
rescued
does,
from
though.
His uncle. He got rescued from his uncle.
Okay, well, the rest of them got rescued.
Well,
from Daenerys.
The last season he got rescued by Sansa.
Yeah.
So he just keeps
he's
getting
just,
rescued
yeah,
by
it's
female
like you,
characters.
You
then
dummy.
He got
but
brought back to
life
by what's
her name.
He's the only
one willing to be at the front of the lines, is the thing. He's not just like a general. He is also a fighter. Like, he does not want to be sitting back. It's part of war, right?
Yeah.
I mean, he's not playing it. He's not playing it like Tyrion's playing it. Tyrion wants to sit at home and tell people what to do.
Well, it's because he's not a good fighter.
No, he's awful.
And he's half the size of everyone, so he doesn't have
but
that on
his side.
But
he is my favorite
side.
Character.
I love Tyrion, yeah. I think he's great.
I mean, yeah. Yeah. I think also George R. R. Martin has said he's my favorite character. He's his favorite character.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I think it's just... And I get why. I get why you have to do it. You have to wrap up storylines. It's just the things that I appreciate about the show is, like, the fact that they really do take their time with things, like, to at a pace that's often aggravating, you know? Like, when you're just sitting there episode after episode watching Arya just... suck and you're just like, oh my god, but like it gives you an appreciation for the skills that they have, and now it just feels like they've lost all of that, and I get why, but at the same time it's like I think they could have been more clever about designing the situations that they've designed.
How are we feeling about the season finale? Do you guys have high hopes for it, low hopes?
It'll be good. It's 80 minutes. Yeah, it's gonna be nice and long.
Yeah.
Have you actually thought, so I know people did dislike the last episode. I mean, disliked it relative to the rest of like Game of Thrones or even the season relative to the rest of Game of Thrones. But is it bad? Are you saying you didn't like it? It's worse.
Did you not enjoy yourself?
Yeah.
This season.
I mean, it always has like moments that are enjoyable. Like when Daenerys destroyed the Lannister armies a couple weeks ago.
Oh, that was very enjoyable.
One of the highlights of the series, I think. Just, it was like, to see the dragons in action.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It always gives you something to keep you invested.
Pretty early on in the season, too. I mean, there's only six episodes, right?
Seven. Yeah. Mm. And I mean, I've watched it this far. I'm not going to stop watching it.
No.
Of course.
So.
Yeah. I'm still enjoying myself, and I feel like at the end of every episode, we get kind of like a cliffhanger, and enjoy that. I enjoy the cliffhangers like a lot, so I think that's one of my favorite parts about it.
What do we have any predictions for what's going to happen? Can we do maybe a prediction segment for like you can say something like, I think this is the episode where John and Danny are going to hook up. Do we think this is what's going to happen?
So there's obviously going to be action.
There's
like what type of action?
Sexual? No. There's going to be a big battle. Who is it going to be between, though?
I want a yes or no if we think John and Danny are gonna bone. Yes
they
or
better.
No?
Not yet.
Yes.
I think they're gonna wait.
I think it's too
next season.
Too
I'm gonna
soon.
Say yes.
Okay. I'm gonna say no. I think it's too soon. We gotta.
No. All right. We'll see.
Yeah. I was.
Well,
because
they're all
happen.
There in King's Landing, right? They're gonna be there, like camping out,
is
sleepover
John
camp.
Be there?
Sleepover
it seems
camp.
Like he was on the boat.
Oh yeah, he's on the
for
boat
for some reason.
Them. Yeah,
he's just.
That's fine.
this is going to be an odd. Yeah, it's going to be an odd meeting because they're going to bring the White Walker that they captured
right
to Cersei. I don't. You guys know more than I do too because I don't watch the trailer for the next episode ever.
Oh, okay.
I never watch those.
I do. I shouldn't.
Yeah.
It didn't give much away.
No, it didn't. Not this time.
I think we're just back in King's Landing, or everybody's coming to King's Landing. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, nobody's going to fight. Not gonna
they're all
going to
meet up,
I mean,
and it's going
to
be crazy.
There has to be.
Maybe Cersei will blow them all up again.
Arya could like be crazy and do something crazy. Cersei could do something crazy that we don't expect. We don't know. It's all up in the air.
Oh, and she's pregnant.
Yep.
Oh, here's what happens.
With a retarded love child.
Here's what happens. The new Ice Dragon is going to also going to go to King's Landing. I think they show up.
He sits at the table. Yeah.
Maybe not in that capacity. He's just going to go to the basement and like cry.
I do think
his
he's going to shoot ice from his mouth instead of fire, which is going to be badass. But anyway.
I feel like that whole process is too easy. I feel like if you're like the whole turning dead things and people into one like
you
I know
you want to see a
long-winded just
seance?
Puts his hand on something.
Dude, they're powerful,
says some mumbo
jumbo. Don't underestimate them.
They're powerful and they have
there
no
was
personality.
A big there was a big controversy as to where did they get those chains.
Nah,
who where did they
care.
Get those chains to get that dragon out?
That's a very good point. You know
do they have some
done.
Sort of a forgery up
it's
there
true.
In the,
how do they do that?
The north?
I mean, a lot of armies that go up there die
the
and all their stuff.
Well,
so
they're
maybe.
Pretty smart. I don't know how
ahead.
They're that smart.
Yeah, they just went and found
if
some chains.
If they're dead.
And like
but. Who swam to the bottom of that lake to hook those chains on? Was it some, like, did they get a White Walker to swim to the bottom? Because the White Walkers can't swim, as
maybe
we learned.
There are mermaids.
Yeah, exactly. They couldn't step
zombie
in the water,
mermaids.
So how did they hook
oh,
us?
The kings can. The kings are, they're obviously more adept
zombie
at doing...
Fish.
You like the Night King is more adept at doing like
zombie
actual
penguins.
They better patch up these plot holes before this boat sinks.
There better be zombie penguins.
Happy Feet, Ice Edition.
All right,
Ice
Kevin.
Zombie Edition.
What?
Okay.
Watch some more things.
I'm
just kidding, Jessica.
Okay, so I watched Daredevil this week, and Dylan and I have been watching Daredevil, and we really enjoy it. It's a Netflix series, and we're getting close to the end of the first season, and it's pretty
dark,
enjoyable.
Guys. It's gritty.
It's dark, but it's fun. It's like a fun superhero show,
it's
and
great
I enjoy
actor.
It. Mm-hmm.
I'm really enjoying it.
Yeah, it's really good.
He was in Downton Abbey.
He was in. Oh yeah, he was.
He's in also in Boardwalk Empire.
Mm-hmm.
I think you meant Downton Abbey.
Yeah, he's very handsome. I enjoy him as an actor too. And then I watched the final episodes of the 13th season of Grey's Anatomy, which is the most recent season. And it was very good. And they always do a season finale that like just pulls at your heartstrings and also just makes you so anxious the entire time because you have no idea what's going to happen. It's always like some sort of, you know, we had one season finale with a shooter in the hospital and
best episode of television
happen.
Of all time.
Yeah. And then we had another episode season finale where they crashed a plane and then all these people were dying. And then they had it, you know, this one was like, spoiler alert. It was like there was a rapist in the hospital who, got an accident with the patient and, And then there was a fire, and that's all I'm gonna say. So, but
in one episode,
there was a rapist episode. Like on the loose.
On the loose,
he was just running around
on
the
loose.
Hospital.
On the loose in the hospital. Really crazy, but I loved it, and I love Grey's Anatomy, and I think it keeps. I think it's for as long as it's been going on, I feel like it still holds up, and I really still enjoy it, and it still makes me cry, and yeah, it's great.
We talked about this last week, didn't we?
Yeah, we talked about Grey's Anatomy. Because, yeah, Shonda Rhimes, the Netflix deal.
Right. Yep. Got it.
My problem with Daredevil is he fights for Hell's Kitchen, is the area of New York City that they all, like, that he lives in and he, like, fights to protect.
Right.
And Hell's Kitchen is really freaking nice. Like, there's no problems with crime in Hell's Kitchen anymore. No. So I just don't buy it.
Well, I don't think they would just change the location because those comics were probably written in the 70s.
Yeah.
Right, back when it was.
Yeah, exactly. But it's based in modern times, and I'm like,
right.
You're like, it's not a bad place anymore.
You can't find a place in Hell's Kitchen for.
I think just because it sounds bad, like Hell's Kitchen sounds bad, and it goes with Devil, Daredevil, Hell's Kitchen. Mm-hmm. It all goes together, so that's why I think
that's
continue with that.
Has the Defenders come out yet?
Yeah.
It's
out.
Okay.
Week before last, I believe.
Has anyone
seen it? No, I'm trying to watch all the series, all the other series individually before I watch Defenders.
It's
I hear
too
Iron
much.
Fist. It's hard.
It's all too much.
I
don't know. There's something.
What if they were a little
boring.
Short, sweet, 20 minutes?
I would watch it so much more.
Yeah.
Mm. If they're just the hour-long episodes and, like, it's good. Like, I like the big bad in Daredevil, Vincent D'Onofrio.
Mm-hmm. King
is.
He's great.
He's just like a Nicolas Cage type. You know, he's gonna put that sauce on.
Oh wait, not King.
And,
I think he's supposed to be. I don't know what his character's supposed to be, but he's good.
Yeah. I don't know,
he's
but
a
there's
good, bad guy.
I just the superheroes. I'm not the most. I can't.
Yeah.
Care as much as I need to watch. Mm. Like I'll watch some from every so often, but I have to just constantly be watching.
How's the Tick going?
The Tick is I'm on episode 2, 3.
Okay.
And it's great, and it's. But it's refreshing, I'll say that much.
Right.
They're 20-minute long.
Yeah, I hear it's very meta, and it's almost kind of making fun of superhero.
Yeah,
like modern superhero tropes.
But in a it's yeah, I don't know. I've liked it a lot so far.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. is this you? This is you.
One of them's me.
I added Rick and Morty to yours because I figured you were watching it.
Okay.
I watched the latest one actually.
I haven't.
You're like in every
finished
third
the
episode
latest
you
one.
Watch. That's weird.
I haven't finished the latest
okay.
Rick and Morty. I started watching it and something happened and I turned it off and I haven't gotten back to it.
That's good.
I am watching Documentary Now, which I showed Kevin the other night at my apartment and he fell asleep. It's a great show. It's Fred Armisen and Bill Hader and Seth Meyers are the creators. John Mulaney does a lot. Yeah, I get a lot of that whenever I talk about this show. But it's really good. I think it's really worthwhile. They take a documentary every week and they kind of make like a half hour like homage / satirization of it. So if you like documentaries and you've seen a lot of documentaries, it's a show to watch. If you haven't,
I still
recommend it.
Is that supposed to be Grey Gardens, by
yes,
the way?
Yes, exactly.
It's the best episode.
So good. They end up being,
awesome.
I think, like serial killers or, at the end.
Is it like a found footage, like horror kind of movie?
Yeah.
I really like Grey Gardens, but that's funny.
But Fred Armisen is Big BB.
Yeah.
What they call
it. And Bill Hader's just freaking impressive in this show.
He is.
He does some really solid just acting work that, like, it's sketch comedy, I guess, but like he just does some stuff that you're like, damn, like you have range.
Yeah,
they're both great. I really enjoy both of them, so I would definitely watch this.
Yeah,
and I really want to get more into watching Portlandia. I've only seen a couple episodes, but I enjoy it too.
The most recent episode I watched was does anybody like the Talking Heads? Band, the Talking Heads.
I do like the Talking Heads.
Well, they apparently there's some documentary of like their last final concert. Intercut with like,
them. One of our friends
and
wanted
so,
to do
oh, yeah.
see that
yeah and mm-hmm. But so the way that they did it is they actually created a Talking Heads type band. I think I can't remember what the name of their band
is it the Blue Jeans one or was that
no that
was
that was
one.
Last season.
Okay.
This season it's like they have their own Talking Heads type band and they wrote all this music and they actually put on a full concert for like a crowd of people, and it's just it's them playing all the instruments, and then like they cut and they have like the little interviews in between, but like they actually put on a full concert.
That's cool.
Of them playing the music, so
that's really cool.
Yeah.
How'd you like the most recent Rick and Morty?
So okay, I don't know if it actually was the most recent. Is it the Vindicators? Or is that an older
That was not
one?
The most recent
okay,
one.
Okay, then never mind. That's the last one I watched. Was
the Vindicators is great, though.
That was the one before last. This most recent one was they were at a theme park. It's mostly an episode between Rick and I forget his name.
Jerry,
the guy that's played by Adam. No, who's he played by?
Oh,
Chris Parnell.
Parnell. Yeah. It was mostly about their relationship. So that is his father-in-law. I think still legally, because I think they're just...
They haven't divorced.
Yeah, I don't think they're actually divorced. I don't even know if they're, like, legally separated, but... I won't spoil it for you guys, but it was fun. I don't think it's going to stand the test of time like Pickle Rick will, but it was good. I mean, yeah, it was a lot of fun. I mean, there's always, like, some, like, little fucking thing in there that just really gets me. They like, there's this really intimidating monster guy that's talking to Rick, and he's got him, like, in a broom closet at a restaurant, and he's like, you better fucking do this thing or I'm going to kill you, blah, 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 blah. And then a coworker, like one of the workers at the restaurant comes in, and he's like, somebody ordered the snoozle dazzle, and he's like, oh, they did. And so he, like, he puts on a party hat and he, like, walks out. So, like, he was this big intimidating guy. But then you hear him in the background going, like, snoozle dazzle, snooze. It's just so stupid. Yeah. So it's great. I love this show. All right. This is mine. I've been rewatching Archer. I think I'm on season two now, but I've seen everything. I think
What's the most recent season? What's going on in the most recent season? Are they back at ISIS?
Well, I think season three they stopped using ISIS because
there's a real ISIS.
Then the, yeah,
right, exactly.
The Middle Eastern ISIS.
But they
existed.
Did like the Miami Vice season, right? Like
yes, yeah. Yes. I can't even remember. I like all of Archer's because it's just like every season kind of has a theme now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
They started doing that like five or six seasons in. I love it. Like the promotional stuff is great. This might be my favorite animated show on television right now. I can't think of anything else that makes me as happy as this show.
Bob's Burgers.
No.
Bob's Burgers.
No. I watched like the first couple episodes and I don't think I get it. I think I probably should continue watching.
I like Bob's Burgers. I think it's fun.
Yeah, I
gotta
keep going.
But I like Archer more than Bob's Burgers, I think, too.
I was even looking at the style of the art style, too. I think it's gorgeous.
Sure.
The writing
is so... You like it more than Rick and Morty?
Oh, well...
That's an animation.
God, yeah, we were just talking about that, huh? Oh, man. I feel like I'm doing a disservice to everybody if I were to say that I like Archer more.
You can say it. You got to trust your heart.
Yeah.
Follow your heart.
Go with your heart and gut.
I think because of the ensemble of Archer, I think I like it more.
Sure.
You know, Rick and Morty is just one or two characters that I love. But this has a lot of characters that I love. I mean, obviously, Archer the most. And I think Archer just stands out more. I mean, why would you do this to me?
H. John Benjamin's just great.
The other thing I'm not actually watching. It's a podcast, but it's called the Writers Panel. It's on the Nerdist Network, and they talk to writers. It's similar to that of what's his name from who is the, what's the name of the guy? He was in part of Groundlings. He's the principal in Community.
Oh yeah,
can't remember his real name. The dean.
Oh,
I can't remember his name.
Jim, something.
It Jim sounds right. Oh God,
Jim
damn it.
Jim.
He was part of Groundlings. I actually saw him do some improv. He's amazing. Jim Rash. He has another show that's a lot like this. I think it's called Writer's Room.
Oh, I've seen an episode of that.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. I love hearing what writers have to say, because I feel like, I mean, they're the most important part of television and film. I mean, I think there's a lot of really good actors. Now, are there a lot of good writers? I'm sure there are, but like that's, I feel like that's the real creativity behind all of these things. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know. It's what I love. So I listen to Writer's Panel. And I listen to the most recent one I listened to was, I'm kind of skipping around, but they were talking about It's Always Sunny, and they talked to the guy that plays Dennis Reynolds. And God damn it, what's his name? My favorite character from that show.
Charlie Day.
Charlie Day, and they talked to Charlie Day also. And I found out, I'm learning some new terms, like block filming. You guys know this term? Where they film seasons in blocks, so they'll film 5 episodes at a time as opposed to every week doing a new thing. Which I think how most episodes are, or most television shows are ran, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, they'll film like 5 episodes at a time. And I don't know how long the seasons are for It's Always Sunny. Or I'm sorry, how many episodes there are in a season.
I think they're getting shorter. I think
maybe
like
a dozen
episodes.
Yeah.
Yeah,
something like that.
12.
And it was just really interesting to get insight on that for It's Always Sunny. They're all come from a drama background. None of them have a comedy background. And yet they're like maybe like one of the more prolific comedy shows
Dennis
right now.
Reynolds studied at Juilliard.
Oh.
Went to the Juilliard.
Holy crap, acting. That's weird.
Yeah. Crazy.
No wonder why Dayman's such a good song.
Yeah.
it's just great to get some insight. I know one of the guys from Cineverse, he watches a lot of the writers, actors, producers, they do like roundtable things. I forgot who puts on these roundtables. Not Hollywood Reporter. Somebody puts on these really fun roundtables. I like those types of things. You remember the show? Who did Made with Vince Vaughn?
John Favreau?
Yeah, mm-hmm. John Favreau used to have a show. It was a roundtable show.
That makes sense.
On HBO. It's an older show now, but he would just talk to his actor friends and his writer friends and producer friends.
Swingers.
Oh God, I love Swingers. I love Swingers and Made. I don't know if you've seen
first
these.
Iron Man directed the first.
He
Iron
directed
Man.
The first Iron Man, but him and Vince Vaughn were creative partners for a long time, and they made these two really good films,
yeah.
Pretty much back to back. I think within years.
Yeah, I think within I can't remember years. Swingers. I think came out in like 96 maybe or something, time around there. Number 95
sounds about right.
And Made came out in like it was like maybe like 6 years after that.
Yeah,
it some time had passed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Good movies. I feel like that was very tangential. But anyways, that's what I'm listening to and writing cool. about. So, who picked this one?
I did.
Yes. Cool. So this was last week's Screen Source Required Viewing. Mm. And we all went out and watched it?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yes. You must have watched it last minute. So, what did you all think?
I liked it a lot. I thought it was very fun. I thought it was a lot funnier than I expected it to be. And I really enjoyed it. I thought it was a good time.
I thought Adam Driver was fantastic.
That's the bad guy?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, from Star Wars?
From Star Wars, yeah, yeah. He plays Kylo Ren.
And Girls?
Yeah, I don't know if I'd seen... he's always like a very intense presence.
Mm-hmm.
And he's just
not
like very
one.
Like laid back and almost dull. But
uh-huh.
It's just
been in
really
a good
well.
Way.
It was... go ahead, Jason.
I liked it. I had some problems with it. Yeah, I don't know. I think, so from what I read about the movie, Steven Soderbergh was a big proponent of making movies outside of the traditional studio system.
Okay.
And I think this was supposed to be like a big experiment where he was trying to get like private funding outside, and it wasn't just a studio, so that he can have more creative freedom.
Hmm.
You know, because that's always the argument is that, you know, you're making it like... in the Disney studio system or in the Warner Brothers, they can kind of step in and be like, put some weight on your shoulders and say like, we want you to change Star Wars. We don't think people are going to like this or whatever. It's
mm-hmm.
not going to make as much money. We did some research and people prefer it if you do it this way. And so that was supposed to be his like big thing. However, it seems like a very Hollywood movie to me, which isn't a bad thing.
Yeah, it didn't feel like an indie film.
Yeah. And the cast was just full, brimming with stars.
Mm-hmm.
Except
for that girl. What's she been in?
Riley Keough?
Yeah.
She's been in Mad Max Fury Road. She was in that movie with Shia LaBeouf that came out last year, American
yeah.
Honey.
I feel like she's not a huge actress yet. Like
yeah, she's the smallest
yeah.
one.
Yeah, is she A-list yet?
She's
not
on
yet.
Her way. I think she does a series with Soderbergh on Showtime or something.
Okay.
Called the... I forget what it's called, but
she was good.
She was good.
She's
yeah.
Elvis's granddaughter.
Okay, that makes sense.
Oh,
yeah.
She looks like it. I could tell.
Wait, why does that make sense?
I don't know.
She looks
not,
like
not
she looks
impressed
like
by her.
No, she was fine. I mean, I haven't seen her do anything that's mind blowing, but I didn't dislike her. And in fact, I appreciated her because I liked that she was a face that I didn't know, and she's the first character we meet other than Logan, Channing Tatum there. And I thought, oh, this is going to be like a very like low key, like gritty, like movie with a bunch of like I didn't know Adam Driver was in. I guess I didn't do enough research. And then all of these megastars started popping up, and it really took me out of that like hillbilliness. Mm-hmm. It took me out of like, oh, these are like, you're British and you're, you know, Han Solo's son, and you're like.
007.
Hillary
yeah,
Swank,
yeah,
and you're,
yeah.
you know.
Katie Holmes.
Yeah, Hillary Swank.
And you're
killed
Katie
like,
Holmes.
Jesus, everybody's showing up in this movie.
And at first, I thought it was going to be like a very, like. We're like we were going to be in this world of like the grit, and we're going to have a bunch of like, if they're not no name actors, like kind of smaller actors that fit into that world, mm-hmm. and they did a good job, but I was kind of taken out of it a little bit.
Did you guys?
Their star power was too much.
I liked the visual. I liked it visually. Thought it was pretty. I thought they had really good shots in it. Did you guys like the story?
I did. I feel like heist movies are kind of. Interesting sometimes because like most of the movie is preparing for the heist, mm-hmm. but you don't want to give away like the climax before it happens.
Yeah,
so
it's like
has
a
to 70% be, like, a twist or something has to go wrong. And then so for a little while I was like, I just don't understand how this is going to come together.
Yeah.
Like a lot of the preparation, like I wanted to see more of the preparation and planning and stuff.
There's a little bit of like, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but my problem was there's not very much was explained as to how and why this guy was such a genius at pulling off this heist.
Yeah, exactly. It wasn't like Ocean's 11 where it's like, this is
you
what
get
he does,
all these expert.
I don't think I don't think I needed that. I thought like, okay, he deals with explosives and that's all they know too. I don't know if they knew much else, and they and we find that out too because then later on he's. You find out he's a chemist, and they're unimpressed by the fact that he's not bringing in an enormous bomb.
Just stick a dynamite.
Yeah, I guess we should preface this by saying spoilers. But I thought it got gradually funnier and funnier, which I was like impressed by because I went through like some roller coasters of like, I guess you know I could see myself liking it. No, I'm not so sure anymore. And then like it just kept doing it. It did this, but it went up.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was impressed by this movie.
Yeah, by the end I was like I was happy with it. I didn't I realized I didn't really need all that explained because the payoff was worth it, I guess.
I do want it explained in my heist movies. I mean, I guess like because the whole point of a heist movie is to like have some sort of clever puzzle.
But now you're asking for like I need a heist movie proper. And this wasn't it was very different type of heist movie.
Yeah,
we've never seen
a heist
movie like this.
Mm-hmm. I mean it was in the same vein of like an Ocean's 11, but I also saw Baby Driver, which I guess that had some plot holes as well, but and maybe I'm just holding this up to like Baby Driver and I preferred that movie. I guess that wasn't
that
a technical heist movie, but
when that thing pops back out and he catches it. I mean, we all just lost it. And also, oddly enough, like, everybody we were in the theater with was, like, over 50 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which is strange, because you wouldn't expect really that. But it did remind me, Jason, of Ocean's 11 a little bit.
Well, Steven Soderbergh did both. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, and I really like Ocean's 11. So.
I was interested in the setting. I don't have, like, a particular love for the culture of the South.
Yeah, it's interesting. There's been this resurgence of like Trump country set movie. Like we had Hell or High Water last year.
Yes.
And then I feel like this is a very similar.
And Hell or High Water was modern heist also?
Yeah. They were robbing banks in that one.
Right.
And that was in Texas. But yeah, it just feels like all of a sudden, and I know you said this isn't Hollywood, it was outside the Hollywood, but it still felt.
Yeah.
It was still Hollywood.
Yeah.
It's just like this attempt to like reach out to middle America.
You think that's what this was?
I don't know if that was intentional or it just feels like a lot of movies that have been coming out.
It was still
out.
Pretty charming though in a way because I think they had like Channing Tatum liked John Denver, which is he's like not the typical like country music person that you think of nowadays. Like he's like an old country person. So I liked that aspect of it, that it wasn't like new he wasn't listening to like new country and like, I don't know. I felt like it was kind of charming. I did notice that Daniel Craig's accent kind of broke sometimes, and I was like, I can hear the British accent still underneath that fake Southern accent.
It's weird because I find that like for Americans, that's probably the easiest accent for us to.
Mm-hmm.
But for British people, they have a hard time.
With yeah.
Getting the American Southern. It's a very like it's a strange dialect for them to.
Yeah.
Right.
And I've heard them have problems with it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. I thought all of them performed well, though. I was actually like at first, because again, I was talking about kind of the culture of like the South and like they were trying to represent that. And then I was thinking to myself, like, man, I feel like they're maybe pushing it a little too hard, even because some of these people were obviously slower and just stupid. Yeah, just stupid. And I was like, are they just going to represent every Southern person in this film as an idiot?
But is that misrepresenting? Not to be mean about it.
Right. Yeah, that's what I was wondering. But you know, no, they're actually like no. I mean, when I look back at it, I mean, what's his name? He's a chemist, and he was showing chemistry on the wall.
Yeah.
At the very end of the movie, the turn, the plot twist, he fucking duped everybody.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're not. It's just like I was like wondering like the narration, and then also the his brothers, the two other brothers that were in the movie, they obviously were stupid.
Yeah, no, it was sort of like a Fargo situation where you're like meant to underestimate these characters because they're like they have
because
a funny accent and they're not from New York or wherever. But
right,
in the end, it's like they're like they pulled it off. And
I love the like it's like janky even. Like they have this giant hose that's pouring out money and like I mean that's memorable to me.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like a typical heist movie. Mm-hmm. Again,
yeah.
they're not like Mission Impossible-ing a
right.
going down the vents or anything, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It was fun. Had a good time. So overall.
Yeah. It was like a B. Fun. I would give it a B.
Give it a B?
Yeah, I'd probably give it a B, the B minus. I liked it and it was enjoyable. I thought that there were too many. I thought there were too many like thing instances, and I guess the name of the movie is Logan Lucky, where he just had to like he planned on like people doing things that he could not have possibly known they were or
right.
were not going to do. So I was that's nitpicky, but so I'll give it a. But I still liked it and enjoyed the movie enough.
Yeah.
I'll give it a B minus.
Yeah, give it a B.
I'll give it a B also.
Yeah, feel safe.
Buzz buzz.
All right, good job, Soderbergh and all these people. All right. This week, so Jessica was going to pick the film, but she's out next week. So maybe we look for another host. We might have one of our producers in the back come out and host. So we decided that we'll just push hers back a couple weeks because she's going to be gone next week. She can't talk about it if she picks the movie.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to pick a movie this week, and I'm going to pick Mother.
Mother.
Now, you're She'll giving me the smiley nothing. Face, so I think you've seen this movie.
I haven't seen it. I'm familiar with it. And who's the director again? Is it
Park
Chan-wook or it's not?
I'll figure it out right
director
now.
Director of The Host.
Director of The Host.
Which
I've seen The Host also.
It's not
have
Park
you seen
Chan-wook.
This?
I have not seen this
no,
movie.
Old boy.
Mm-hmm.
So here's the thing is that I am a big fan of Korean films. I think they're fantastic.
Yeah,
they. I think one of the reasons I like them so much is because it has American sensibilities, so I can relate to it. There's some Japanese films where I'm like, this is too much. Like, I don't know what the fuck is going on.
Mm-hmm.
I just don't understand that. Some like Latin films where I don't connect it in some certain way. But I feel like for some reason I connect to South Korean films.
Yeah,
Korean films are. They've got a thriving cinema
industry.
Culture.
Yes,
yeah.
Absolutely. And China's coming
and
up
beautiful.
Too.
Yeah.
I just. And there's like two directors, I think. God, I'm having such a problem. I mean, I should just type in Korean film. Because I'm looking it up, and it's giving that new Mother film that's coming out.
Oh, yeah,
that
yeah.
we watched a trailer for last week.
We watched, Dylan and I most recently watched The Handmaiden.
Oh, I haven't
God,
seen
it's
that.
So
and it is
good.
So good.
It is.
Oh,
not
it
The Handmaid's Tale.
Bong Joon-ho.
The Handmaiden.
Bong Joon-ho.
Who also did, I believe... Memories of a Murder.
He also did the
he
new
do Memories of Murder.
Was that him or was that someone else?
Here, I'll find out his filmography right now. So he did, Memories
Bong
of a Murder, Jr. which I have not seen.
Memories of Murder is great.
He did The Host, which was a great. Monster film.
Mm-hmm.
He did Snowpiercer, which got a lot of buzz. He did Okja, a Netflix original.
I haven't watched that one yet.
That Jessica and I watched. I liked it.
I liked it.
Yeah, it wasn't bad. I didn't love it. Yeah. Dan Harmon, I'm pointing because there's Dan Harmon on the, on another screen over here. He interviewed one of the co-producers, or an executive producer, sorry, of the film recently on Harmontown, his About podcast, and he said it's a perfect film, Okja,
really?
Which I thought was interesting. Wow. He could have just been nice, but anyways, I've heard about Mother a lot. Mm-hmm. I like this director. I'm not in love with his films like I am with that of the other gentleman that you guys said.
Park Chan-wook.
Yeah, I love his films more. He did the Lady Vengeance trilogy.
Sympathy for Mr. Vengeance.
Yes. Lady Vengeance. Old Boy is most popular. I think he did Thirst, if I'm not mistaken. I wanted to watch that this week. Did you guys
see
Thirst?
But that's okay.
I'm sorry, what?
He made a movie. I think it's called I'm a Robot, But That's Okay.
Okay.
Love story.
Oh, that's what it's called.
Cool.
The woman who thinks she's a robot because she works in a factory making phones or something. And
that's
she just
so cool.
Begins to identify as a robot.
That's awesome. There's another there's an old Japanese film. It's called Tetsuo the Iron Man. Okay. He slowly turns into a robot, and you watch it happen through the film. God, it's fucking weird. It's got to be one of the weirdest, creepiest movies I've ever seen. There's a point where his, he looks down and his dick's turning into a drill bit. It is weird. It is creepy, dude.
I think I've heard of
that. Anyways, I keep hearing things about Mother. Again, I wanted to pick another. Maybe I'll pick a South Korean film that I haven't seen that I've been wanting to see. I also heard recently, another reason that made me think about picking South Korean films is that the Writer's Room, that's the name of the podcast I'm listening to, right? The guy that plays Dennis Reynolds, also a huge fan of South Korean films. And he prefaced it by saying, I feel pompous saying this. I don't want to sound like I'm being snooty, I watch international films or whatever. But I mean, come on, let's watch films outside of the U.S.
Sure.
There's a lot of countries making good film.
Yeah, lot.
And he's also a huge fan of South Korean films. And he was talking about, I saw The Devil, I think was a film that came out a couple of years ago. It was supposed to be thriller, if I'm not mistaken. I really like South Korean thrillers also. And I think this is leaning more towards a thriller, if I'm not mistaken. Mother, I won't give you any details away. Again, I haven't seen it, but as far as what I understand, I think her or her son are accused of murder, and the mother is trying to find out who did it.
Okay.
And she'll go to any length. She'll stop at nothing, so it says this, to figure out who it was. And I think it gets a little bit crazy.
Cool.
So, I check to see if it was available on Netflix or Amazon? I'll figure it out. But
I think it's available possibly on Netflix or Amazon.
So you can rent it on Amazon. Mm. Or something.
Okay. Yeah, something like that. So if we have a problem finding it, you guys come over. I'll run it. Yeah.
Cool.
Sounds good.
Yeah, I'm excited for this. I've told you I went to South Korea for over the summer once in college and took a course on Korean film. It's been a while.
Yeah, yeah, but you're a fan of Korean films also.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Korean films.
Cool, you should definitely watch The Handmaiden.
Yeah, that's very pompous.
Oh, The Handmaiden.
Is that pompous of me to say?
No.
So says Dennis Reynolds.
No, guys, it's not pompous.
You should only like Logan Lucky style films that are take place in Tennessee.
Mm-hmm. It was West Virginia.
Do you guys like any other international from other countries types of movies?
I follow directors, so I got into Hong Kong through Wong Kar-wai, because I was there a period in high school and college where I just watched all of Wong Kar-wai's movies.
Very cool.
I like a lot of Mexican directors.
Oh,
not
yeah.
Alejandro Iñárritu. I don't like I don't
like
his films,
Alfonso
but I love
Guillermo
del Toro and I love
Guillermo del Toro.
Great.
Those are the two that come to
my
mind.
My problem with Guillermo is that I feel like every movie he's doing I get excited about, and then I wait, and then 9 months or 3 years later, it's
he's not doing it
anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
And you're like,
what's happening?
He's hit or miss for me. I don't love all his films. God, Pacific Rim did so well, and I did not like it.
I didn't enjoy it that much.
There were moments in that movie that I really, really loved.
Some of the writing, it's some of the worst writing I've heard in a film in a while. It was just very.
I don't know.
Made
I don't know
public.
That I was invested in
I
it.
I don't know. That sounds pompous, actually.
Oh, yeah. It does.
Yeah, it does. Absolutely. But I just, the writing was bad.
Yeah, I didn't enjoy it that much.
I have to watch it again. I watched it at the new IMAX theater.
Oh, okay.
When it first opened, and they were having like $2 movies.
Well, that's
I got there late, and it was in like the second row.
So here's the thing: is I heard I watched it wrong. I heard that's how I was supposed to watch it. Like just mute it and just take it as the spectacle as it is.
So loud.
It is a spectacle.
It was so loud.
Visually and
it's just everything. It was overwhelming. So I don't remember a lot of it, but I just I remember thinking it was good.
Giant robots fighting each other.
Mm. Yeah, that's all it is.
I tend to like a lot of French and Italian films. I really like Life is Beautiful. I don't know if you guys have seen that, but it is such a good movie, such a good film.
You tried to get me to pick that one this week, right?
Huh? No. I just think it's a great movie, and I also think Amelie is a great film. I really like Amelie.
Yeah, that's cute.
I like Audrey Tautou a lot. I think she's great.
Australian, New Zealand. I like their comedy is so good.
Yeah.
I was looking up Chan-wook Park. Might be my favorite, you know, out of U.S. director. Old Boy, Handmaiden. You guys got to watch that. One of the critics that we really like, she said it was her favorite movie of 2016.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm inclined to agree that's top
graphic,
three for me.
So if you aren't good with sexually, it's graphic.
Okay.
If you're not down with the sexually graphic stuff, then
that's true.
You won't enjoy it. But if you're fine with that, then you'll be good with it.
Cool. Thirst, it's about a vampire, but it's like a vampire drama.
Yeah.
You know, it's good stuff. Anyways, that's my pick.
Real quick, I do have to leave by 6.
Okay.
Cool.
What time is it? 5:52.
Yeah.
All right. You won't see most of the trailers.
Okay.
No. Yeah.
Or any of the trailers, probably.
It's cool. Because.
Question of the week. That's coming from our friends in the back. This is Mr. Orion Kaminky. And or Scott can pick one. Do you have anything for us, Orion? I don't actually know that he can hear us right now.
Hey. You have a question of the week for us?
Question of the week?
Yes.
I have a question of the week.
Okay, you're going to have to yell into that mic.
I can give you the question of the week.
Give it to us.
What is your...
This is a well thought out question. Just give him a second. It's a hard to pronounce word.
Spur of the moment.
What is my what?
What do you think is the most critically acclaimed movie in your opinion?
Most critically acclaimed movie of all time?
Of like all time. This would be the best movie of all time. The most critically acclaimed.
Like
movie.
Citizen Kane.
What we think is or what?
What you think it is.
Oh,
we're guessing.
Not what is the most
critically acclaimed movie.
Not guessing. I just wanted an opinion.
I think they just listed Vertigo as the number, like that beat Citizen Kane.
Yeah, I was going to say Citizen Kane. I remember Roger Ebert once saying that every household needs that movie.
It's fine. It's good.
I won't even watch it. I don't think it's for me.
It's really long.
I mean, the best movie of all time.
I'm still a little confused as to whether or not he's asking us.
No, he said your opinion of what the best movie of all time
is. Oh, got it. We're the critics.
That's a...
My favorite movie of all time is Rushmore. I think it's really good.
Rushmore's really good.
It's just a great movie. It's my favorite movie of all time. I don't know if it's the best movie of all time.
That's the problem, is I know that Goonies is, like, I have a film of nostalgia over me, you know?
Mm.
Yeah.
And I'm inclined to pick a drama because that's how people generally pick dramas as best films.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is a little unfair.
I really liked that movie with Johnny Depp and from Titanic, Kate Winslet.
Oh, Finding Neverland?
Finding Neverland. I thought that was a fantastic movie, and I really, really loved that movie. Mm. But it's not my favorite movie. I just think that it's a really critically acclaimed good movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So.
God damn it. That's tough. You have anything, Kev?
The one that always comes to mind is Notorious by Alfred Hitchcock.
Mm.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
I think that's his best film, and he's one of the best filmmakers to have ever existed.
I do enjoy some Alfred Hitchcock,
I feel like that's a safe bet.
Safe bet.
But if it's just favorite movie, I'll leave it at Notorious.
Okay. I mean, Star Wars? The first movie?
Mm. That's like the best movie?
don't know. Well, do not a lot of people think that?
I think a lot of people do think that. I enjoy Return of the Jedi. Like,
I've never actually heard anybody say that, but Empire obviously biggest though. Series. Okay. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah, I'm just going to say Goonies just because it's hard. That's a hard question.
Yeah.
Rushmore.
I do love the Goonies.
Notorious and Goonies.
Yeah. And I like Finding Neverland as like a critically acclaimed drama. I think it's fantastic. And I enjoyed it.
I have to really think about that one, though.
All right. Game of the week. So we're going to play the same game. I'm glad I did this before you had to leave.
Stalking my social media.
Yep. I had to. You kind of got like cute little Kevin on the... You're so, like, involved. Look at you.
That's because I just lapped my sisters who were in the other go-kart.
Oh, I see.
You were like, yes, I got you.
I beat you. Anyway. Okay. So, yeah, it's the same game as last week.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
just
a
quick
movie,
explanation.
And you all have to guess when it came out, who is in it, a brief summary, what the genre is, et cetera.
Okay.
What is it called?
So this movie is called Black Narcissus.
Black Narcissist.
Narcissus. Not Narcissist. Narcissus.
Narcissus.
Black Narcissus is a Brian De Palma film that came out in 1987. And it was definitely like a noir, like murder mystery that starred Richard Gere. And I'm going to say we need a starlet circa 1987. Somebody help me out. Maybe like a young...
87, huh?
Let's see.
I don't know.
That would be... I'm going to say... and it has to be like a Brian De Palma like style starlet. So let's just say Richard Gere, and then let's say... Winona Ryder.
Cool. I like that.
It is a blaxploitation film from 1972, directed by Martin Scorsese. He's under the impression that this is how a Black Narcissus... he was under the impression that Black Narcissus should be a... It was a kung fu vampire film. Who stars in it? I don't know. and he didn't know either. He went through a long list of young black men and women to create this. Wait, this sounds very similar to my answer from last week.
Yeah.
I was talking about Blade.
Yeah.
That's why.
Uh-huh.
That's why. Okay. Wow. This is, yeah, it is 1970s Blade, is how I take it.
Okay.
But it's got blaxploitation music. very cool Shaft, like, you know.
Damn it. That was so close to my answer. Mine was going to be, this is the sequel to Black Dynamite. It's the same guy that plays Black Dynamite. He's just a little more hot headed now, like narcissistic. And it's like got all the afros and all the, you know, 70s bell bottoms and, you know, very Shaft like also.
Did you see Black Dynamite?
Black Dynamite's great.
Yeah.
Love it.
Funny. So funny.
And I hope Euphoria makes a
comeback.
Okay, so you're all way off. this movie actually, going back to the previous question, could be in the running for my favorite movie.
Oh, Black Narcissus.
Black Narcissus.
Okay,
it's,
should we watch a trailer? How do you want to do this?
Yeah.
Or do you want to explain it?
Why don't we pull up a trailer?
Okay. So that leads into our trailer segment. Generally, it's a watch, rent, or skip is how we go about this. But we're going to show a trailer for Black Narcissus. Actually, I should just save that trailer slide earlier. Oh, I can just type it in here. Black... You got to help me out here.
Narcissus. It's the third one down. Go down. No, one more.
One more.
Trailer. All right.
1947.
Ooh. Holy moly, that's old.
I got the seven right.
All right.
19.
Orion.
My parents weren't even born yet.
Unmuting for trailers. Did you catch that? All right, so,
yes.
All right. Black Narcissus, 1947.
Emmerich Pressburger.
Yes.
On that, produce another screen achievement. Rumor Garden.
This is the story of a high endeavor that tested a woman in the remote background of Asia. The story of a prince and a beggar maid.
What is
this? And of a nun who gave up her vows.
Why should we want to keep you here against your will? Because you're all jealous of me. Especially you.
The clash of strong personalities.
I understood you wanted to see me.
We want to talk to you on business.
I suppose you want to talk to me on anything else.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry.
I don't know why you are being so rude to me, Mr. Dean. I have to talk business with you, whether I like it or not.
The contrast of present peace and self-denial with the rich memories of the full years that have passed. They renounced the world of men, but found that the world was not to be denied.
I gave up my vows. I finished with them up there.
I see.
I love you. I had to have the young general.
It's so good.
I couldn't turn out the holy man. I couldn't stop the wind from blowing and the air from being as clear as crystal, and I couldn't hide the mountain.
I told you it was no place to put a nunnery. It's something in the atmosphere that makes everything seem exaggerated. Don't you understand?
Oh, I love her.
To me,
yeah, it's a weird trailer, but it's basically these nuns, and they move to I forget where exactly, somewhere in India, and they try to start a convent there and like a school for like the children stuff, and the building that they're in used to be a brothel.
Okay.
And so they're trying to like turn it into this holy place, but basically it's like these women who are like, so like, you know, they're nuns, so they're pretty repressed. So they move to this place that's just like bursting with life and sensuality, and it ends up like
corrupting them.
Sort of. It's just like they can't make it work, and then one of the nuns goes crazy, and it's really good.
Cool.
Looks like fun.
Really good.
This and like many other films of that time, it almost films like a play.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? Is that wrong to say?
Probably more of a connection to plays and literature back in those
mm-hmm.
days.
Okay.
Because they didn't have all the luxuries of special effects, CGI.
Well, no, I think what Jason is getting at is that like less films are connected to plays now.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I think for those reasons, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's
yeah.
where they got a lot of the material.
It's more
just the acting style was just yeah. very different back then. It was
mm-hmm.
it was a lot more
drama.
Theatrical.
I like that
yeah.
when they said that guy was being very rude, and he
I
like
know.
Just like mumbled
and
very
he just continued
like,
smoking,
just
blowing smoke.
And they're like,
in
how
their
are
face?
You so rude?
I thought that was
And
funny.
Then the narration right prior to that was a clashing of
personalities.
Personalities.
Strong personality.
Yeah. Old trailers
are fine.
So I won.
You what?
I won this game.
You won.
Nobody
oh,
won.
No,
yeah.
you were all off. I think the closest was probably Jason.
Probably
Jason.
Jason. Yeah, I'm going to
Jason
too.
Because it is sort of a thriller-ish.
Okay. I mean, it looked enthralling.
Yeah.
It's not really noir-ish, which is what I had said.
You know, there's some noir elements to it.
Okay. Nun-noir. Nun-noir.
It's a nun-noir.
Nun-noir.
Nun-noir. Anyway, I have to get going.
Bye, Kevin.
Good.
I'll see you at if
we'll
I get out of here.
Game of Thrones,
if they let
yeah.
me out of here. What time do I need to be at your
so
place?
So when you guys
whenever?
Can just come whenever.
When are you gonna press play?
Seven.
Sharp. All right,
we'll be there.
Just kidding. I mean, if people are running late, that's fine. But
okay. Should Woo! We bring pizza?
Yes.
You should bring pizza.
Just, like trying to bring enough pizza for like, I don't know, 15 people.
Damn, how many people do you have in order tonight? Oh, okay.
He's like, just seven, but I eat pizza
bye,
for
bye.
Seven.
Bye, thank you, everybody.
Hey,
bye.
Yay.
You want to join us?
No, it's
when
cool.
Kevin leaves, Scott steps in.
Game of
That's
Thrones
how it
is
works.
Just as important as this.
This
not
is exciting.
More
so.
So
are we getting a...
hey, what are we talking about here?
Are
hey,
we getting
hey,
good
hey.
Trailer audio?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Sounds
thanks.
Good.
Bye.
Bye,
see you
Kev.
In a bit.
Hey, Kevin.
All right, so let's welcome our replacement host, Mr. Scott Brown.
Hey, I've been watching the whole time.
Whoa.
Cool.
All right. Cool.
That Joss Whedon, am I right?
Okay. So we're moving into trailers now. These are kind of all the new things that came out this week as movies and film. We don't have to go through all of them, but
please
some
don't
of
make
them,
me watch that.
Some of
stupid
them,
cuckoo's
calling
TV series.
I know nothing. Nothing
is,
about
is
this.
Is that based
so I'm going
on that
blind.
Book
we watched
she
it about
wrote
15 times. Warming
before.
It before.
Oh, so. We did. That was the one I was playing.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, I'm interested to see it.
Oh, right. The one we did the audio test.
Yeah, we were
for.
Doing testing.
You're
gonna
kill
us, but I didn't pay attention to
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I didn't pay attention. All right. Yeah.
All right.
All right. Let's get this one going. Is it going to open up? Oh, shit. Sorry. I think I probably fucked you up on your end. Oh, no.
Here we go.
Well, actually.
How's the audio in here?
I didn't want to do that. Oh, it's pretty good. It's pretty
good.
Good. I'm just going to do it old fashioned way, guys.
Copy and
paste.
Mother effing paste.
Copy and mother effing paste.
All
right.
The world knew her as Lula Landry. I think she was murdered.
My name is Corman Strike. I'm a private investigator.
Robin Alicott. I'm the new temp.
So you think Lula Landry was murdered and we messed up the investigation?
She was scared.
The chap they picked up on the CCTV, they never traced him.
What on earth would I need an alibi for?
She was frightened of him.
Lula was in the wrong nest.
Leave me alone!
Little Rock knows more about me than you lot ever will.
Where shall I say you are if anyone important calls?
Down the boozer.
Strike, the cuckoo's calling on BBC One.
The cuckoo's calling.
All right, that was
Strike the cuckoo's.
It's written by J.K. Rowling. It's one of her detective novels that she wrote.
Okay.
That
was too fast for me.
I didn't
catch
much
it.
I saw
anything.
A clip of like a man wolf, and I'm assuming that's the killer. It's just some sort of a man wolf.
Right.
Ignoring Harry Potter.
I bet it's the man wolf. I bet it's the man who can turn into a murderer.
There's a guy.
Wolf.
He's like standing. He's wearing a suit, but he's got a wolf head.
I bet he's the murderer.
It reminded me of The Fall, the show The Fall, which is on Netflix. It's it takes place in Ireland, I believe.
Hmm.
Ireland or Scotland. I believe it's Ireland. And it just had the same kind of tone to it, like a dark, gritty detective thriller.
Does this have anything to do with the book J.K. Rowling wrote under a pseudonym?
It might.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
That was supposed to be a detective thing.
I think
it
might be.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. That would be weird if she wrote it under a pseudonym and then.
As J.K. But then it was like quickly figured out, oh, it's J.K.
Right.
Rowling.
Okay, okay.
Yeah. It was like a news story for like
she
a week.
She wrote Lord of the Rings, right?
Yes. And Star Wars
are you guys
under a pseudonym.
Are you guys going to watch this?
BoJack Horseman?
No.
Oh.
No,
probably not.
Okay, yeah.
I don't know. Maybe
I was not enthralled by the trailer. I'll say
I'm
that.
Kind of interested just because it's J.K. Rowling, so I might
sure
take
I'd give
a crack
it a
at
chance.
It. I'd rent it.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Cool. This is season 4, BoJack. Season.
Hey, BoJack. I haven't heard from you in like 3 months. What's new with me? Did I tell you I'm working at a blog?
You don't care if people read your work or not, and that's what's so great about you.
I don't know if you heard, but Mr. Peanut Butter is running for governor.
I am specifically on the side of the facts and also on the side of feelings.
Well, I'm satisfied.
I really wish you were here for this.
All my life, I've wanted a family.
Would you? Could you? With a mouse?
Wow.
Also, I haven't seen Todd in a while. He's not with you, is he?
No, I never know if I can handle anything. That's what makes my life so exciting.
This is Diane, by the way. Nguyen. Obviously. It's funny. The last time I saw you, you told me that you needed me in your life. And then you just disappeared. Anyway, things are even crazier around here lately.
Hey, whoa.
Stay back.
Come here. I'm not going to hurt you. Ever since I was a baby, people always said I looked like BoJack Horseman.
That's a terrible thing to say to a baby.
The world is dark and scary and full of creepy clown, Dennis. But you gotta push through and hope there's better stuff ahead.
I'm sure you'd say something like, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard.
Where have you been?
Has the whole world gone crazy?
Then you would be so overwhelmed by the unbearable ludicrousness of the situation that you would get in your car and drive to Hawaii. Wherever you are, I hope you're happy. I really do, Bojack.
The mailbox is full. Goodbye.
I don't know, but I really like whatever band that was in the background.
Yeah, that's what I was most. Well, I
was
mean,
it the Walkman? I don't know who it was.
No, it's not the Walkman.
I don't know. I'm gonna go ahead and Shazam that later.
I have seen maybe one episode of BoJack Horseman. That's exactly one of those things you gotta watch it. Oh my god! So I know people who love this show, haven't gotten into it. Probably something I could get into.
Sure.
But season four?
Season four. Okay. Yeah, we got some catching up to do. I'm the same way.
You really got to watch it, guys. It's very good.
Are you excited about season four?
Yeah. I mean, I think the whole show is surprisingly, when it first came out, I thought it was going to be terrible.
Uh-huh.
And I think every step of the way, I've been surprised by, it's pretty funny, but it's also like, it's just well written.
It does look well written.
Poignant in a way that, like, you wouldn't expect from an animated TV show
where humans and upright animals
exactly
coexist.
Like,
yeah,
and yeah, when it first came out, like, I think everybody had that expectation. I think till this day people do, but I keep reading, like, all the reviews I read on it are like, well, that was like very refreshing and unexpected.
So just watch it, get over whatever you have about it.
Exactly.
That's part of the thing, I think, with watching animated series and just kind of stepping out of that comfort zone of most of us don't watch that.
Yeah.
Is like accepting some certain things and then just moving forward.
Yeah.
Yeah, you won't be disappointed. But I mean, this show, it's like, and there are moments of it that are just like very honest and like, you're just like, fuck, shit, that was a deep moment that I watched a cartoon horse have.
Yeah, I like the tone of the trailer, and it felt like honest. I don't know if that makes any sense.
Yeah, no, definitely. It's very like, yeah. They touch on a lot of like issues, like sensitive issues, like abortion and depression, and they treat them with a lot.
He has depression, right?
Yeah,
he's like a washed up
he's
TV
basically
actor from the
like. It's like if John Stamos
reminds me of the plot of Californication.
I don't remember what necessarily was. He a famous actor or writer?
Writer, I believe.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of similar to that. It's like he might as well have been in, like, Full House was, like, I think the basis for the show that he was famous on in the 90s.
Family sitcom.
And that's even the theme song, back in the 90s. Mm. You were in a famous TV show.
Who voice acts?
It's Will Arnett is BoJack.
Aaron Paul is the friend.
What's your name? From Glow and Mad Men.
Allison Brie. Yeah.
Paul F. Tompkins, great voice
great
cast.
Yeah, this is a great cast. It's a lot of good comedians.
Very cool.
And comedy actors. Great.
Next.
Cool. I mean, that trailer actually does make me want to watch.
Yeah.
Watch some BoJack. All right, this is the one that Jason picked out. Little Evil.
Everybody, please welcome Gary.
Well, my wife and I just recently got married.
Gary!
Hey, she's perfect. She's everything I ever wanted. And, you know, I'm having a little tiny bit of trouble bonding with my new stepson, Lucas. Whoa, look at that. You found some earthworms.
Good talking to you, buddy.
Never really looks me in the eye. Doesn't talk much, except when he yells at me to get out of his room. Using this weird little goat puppet thing. I get this sense that he's...
That he's evil incarnate?
Yeah.
Remind me again how Lucas was conceived.
You remember when I told you about that crazy time in my 20s where I joined that sort of, like, cult?
No, I don't think you told me about that.
The Doomsday Cult believes that a child will rise up from hell to rule mankind and to bring on the end of the world as we know it. I think we found that child. And now you're his stepdad.
There is nothing wrong with Lucas. He's very particular.
A child.
you do this to me?
You told me that was normal, that all kids are dicks.
That's true. Kids are dicks, man. But this is a different level. He's like top of the dick chain, bro.
So creative.
You gotta relax, man.
How can I relax? We're in a cornfield.
So?
What good thing has ever happened in a cornfield, Al?
Well, I don't know. Field of Dreams is pretty cool.
That looks entertaining.
All right.
That's great.
Yeah, how'd you find out about this one?
I saw it pop up in my news feed, and I clicked on it. Apparently it comes out like next week.
Yes, I think September 1st it said.
Yeah,
I remember.
Yeah, next week.
It looks hilarious.
It looked funny. Yeah, I mean, we haven't been playing the game. Watch, rent, or skip. And I guess for Netflix, it'd be like watch right away or watch
it. Leave it in your queue.
Yeah.
It's a fun idea. I don't know how it's going to be in actual execution, but
yeah, that
it
is,
looks funny enough.
That's really the question, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's modern day comedy spin on The Omen.
Yeah.
Omen, right? And
I did not like the movie The Omen.
Being the stepdad of the kid from The Omen, essentially.
Yeah, yeah. And kind of like Problem Child.
Yeah.
Does anyone remember Problem Child?
Yeah.
Shitty John Ritter movie. It had its moments. Mm-hmm. But yeah, just kind of ramp it up. Yeah, I definitely watch it.
Yeah, I'll watch it. It looks fun. It's got a good cast.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Trailer was pretty good. Most of the jokes hit, not all of them. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I like the vibe of it.
Yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. kind of just, oh God, this kid's an asshole. Oh no, he's the son of Satan. No, I'm serious. He's the son of Satan.
I'm really sold on that actor from The Office.
Parks and Rec. I really like him a lot. Adam Scott.
So good.
All right. So it looks like most of us, it's a watch.
Yeah, I'll watch it.
You know what? I think this was one of the trailers that we were watching.
Sure is.
Uh-oh.
You know what amazes me about you?
Well, could be anything. I'm a pretty amazing guy.
You turn the keys to your bar over to the guy who's asleep on your pool table, and then you jump in your car, and you drive me to hell and gone, and you don't even know where we're going.
Ask the question, am I willing to surrender to God?
What the hell happened to Mueller the Mauler? First class drinker, gambler.
I see we have some visitors amongst us here today.
We were in the service together with your pastor.
I haven't seen these men in decades. They represent a dark period in my life.
That went down awfully quick.
Drinking for two now that you got old and boring.
Shine down a light on me.
Because of my son, I came here. Found you guys. A year ago, we joined the Corps, and then 2 days ago, they told me that he'd been killed. He's gonna be buried in Arlington, and I was wondering if you guys could come with me.
I've come to you in search of some...
They sent him off to a godforsaken desert.
Why?
I'm taking Larry home.
With all due respect, sir, he deserves to lie at Arlington.
You're gonna take Doc back and try to make it fun.
You're cutting off your nose to spite your face.
Did you look at these faces? They've already been spited.
I thought we were going to a funeral.
We are going to a funeral. Just looks like it's going to take a little longer to get there.
What you going to do? Strap the coffin to the roof of your car?
We could do that.
Oh, man.
The thing that made Larry different from the rest of us, he had a happy childhood.
He said that?
Yes, sir.
If there's 1 minute that's not too terrible, I'd like to try to enjoy it.
His holiness can hardly
walk,
let alone handle a big rig with a hydraulic lift.
This is a rental with an automatic transmission.
You guys ready for an adventure? Let's go.
What do you smell? Urine. I love it. It's like the official scent of the city.
Things that come into your head and out of your mouth.
You worry too much. That's why your hair went so gray.
Could you resist a man in this uniform?
I don't think I could.
You're there for your brothers. Yeah, that's all that really matters.
Get out of the way.
Okay, you want to play? Let's play.
Hey, move! Hey. You trying to get me killed? I will bury your ass.
Mueller has arrived. Woo.
Seems like a poignant film that's not for me.
Yeah, I don't know that we're the demographic for it. It's a skip for me.
Good people in it.
I'll definitely watch it because it's a Richard Linklater movie, and
what else has
Richard Linklater was what's the freaking movie?
That's a huge name.
I mean, a few years ago he made the one about the kid that like spanned 10 years.
About a boy.
No, not about a boy.
Boyhood.
Boyhood. And then
which is about a boy.
But then he also did like School of Rock. He has like a very eclectic repertoire. His biggest one was what's the one in Texas and the kids in high school.
Dazed and Confused. Okay.
Oh, he's been around a long time.
Before Midnight,
all those movies.
I'll give it a shot.
Okay, maybe I'll watch it. Maybe I bump it up to a rent.
Might be one of those you eventually see, but not a
Yeah.
And there's like something gotta
see this one.
It's like a sequel to like a book or like another movie that came out but it wasn't these actors, and it was made like 20 years ago or something. And this is like, and Richard Linklater wasn't involved, but it's like apparently there's like this whole like backstory to who these characters were, and they were the subject of like a book or some other movie.
I think it's a sequel to Wild Hogs.
Yeah.
Or Last Vegas, where Morgan Freeman and Michael Caine go to Las Vegas.
I'm pretty sure they dyed Lawrence Fishburne's hair, at least his eyebrows. They were very, very white.
Mm.
I do like that these actors have so much range, and I don't think are any longer, at least, being typecast for the roles that they're known for.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It was a sequel to a movie that was called The Last Detail, starring Jack Nicholson, Randy Quaid, and Otis Young. And it was a Hal Ashby film in 1973.
Oh, wow.
A sequel to a 73 film?
Yeah.
It's about time.
Is that when Wild Hogs came out?
I think the original is about them like in the army when they're younger.
Okay.
Wow.
So, yeah.
That's kind of cool.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah.
I think I'd watch the original and then watch this. That sounds like a good time, actually.
What does the original have on Rotten Tomatoes?
I do not know.
Okay. I'll look up the next one. So, okay. What is it for you? Is it a rent?
Rent.
Okay. All right. I'm actually excited about this one.
Lego Elves?
Yes. Isn't
there like a Ninjago Lego movie coming out of like the
Ninjago?
Ninjago, that's right.
Mm-hmm.
There's all these Lego movies coming out. Lego Batman was really good.
Yeah.
Once there were five sisters. Air, water, fire, earth, and love.
Wait! They're elves and they live in Elvendale?
Mom and Dad said I had to read you a bedtime story. Do you want to hear it or not?
Not.
Took Sophie to the Goblin King's fortress.
Sophie! She's scared and alone and counting on us to save her.
Yeah.
Oh, that was an interesting ending.
What was that? What?
But it had nothing to do with Legos, though. Why is it called Lego Elves?
Was that a mislabeling, or
Yeah, the new Lego movie does not have Lego style.
It looks like
or any Legos in it.
Yeah.
Right. So my guess is that Lego Elves, there is a story somewhere, and there is a Lego Elf series of toys and stuff. And so I think they were like, hey, let's try something new. I'm seeing some weird...
I will not watch that.
No, I'm not going to see that one.
Skip.
I have nothing but questions.
So I didn't love the trailer. I will say, like, just looking at it visually before it started... like earlier today, I was like, oh, that actually kind of looks, because it kind of looks like Voltron Legendary Defender, which I'm super into right now. And then it also reminds me of like Studio Ghibli films, kind of looks like it.
Is that is like a Japanese style animation in a way,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. Oh, American sensibilities.
Yeah. Definitely not hardcore anime, but.
It looks like it might like be like the demographic, it might be too young. I was thinking maybe, you know, prior to watching that trailer, that I would watch it.
It made me feel old.
Yeah.
like the one with Bryan Cranston made me feel young, and this one makes me feel old.
Yeah. Excuse me. Yeah, so I don't know. Yeah, probably, maybe a rent for me. I don't know if I'd go to skip. This I think is a newer trailer with a surprise.
I was told not to watch this trailer if I wanted. Anyway,
if you didn't want a spoiler or something,
I don't care. Just.
It might be more of a teaser.
It's 2:45.
I missed you, baby sweet.
There's no one in the place.
Was a day,
except you and me.
It was a day. Humanity cannot survive. Replicants are the future of the species, but I can only make so many.
He's got every gun in the city. I've got you.
We have to stop him. What do you want? I thought you might be able to help me with the case. He's constructing an army. Tell me what you remember. Everything. They know you're here.
He's on your tail. I'm coming with you.
What's the plan?
We don't run.
You do not know what pain is yet. You will learn.
All right. So why were you told not to watch that?
I don't know. I just read something. I was like, don't watch the new Blade Runner trailer if you want to be surprised or something.
I think that was the surprise.
Jared Leto is like a baddie
or something. Mm. Something like that.
It looks good. I want to watch it.
I'm still going to see it.
Yeah, for sure. I'll watch it.
Mm. Yeah.
I'm going to watch it because I feel obligated to.
Yep. There's a lot of hype around it.
I actually
like
do not like the original Blade Runner.
I've seen it. I need to rewatch it. I saw it a long time ago. I don't. It's not like I have any nostalgic pull towards it or anything.
I think most people do, though.
Yeah.
All right, cool. It's a watch. Now this, I don't know if it's a... I think it is a trailer. What am I doing here?
Yeah, within the last few days, they came out with this new Black Mirror teaser.
God.
And again, it gave a by episode
knockoff of what's going to happen.
Stranger Things kind of did that last year, if you remember. It was just they didn't show anything, but it was the title of each episode.
Yeah, just like in the font.
I love Black Mirror, so I definitely will watch as soon as it comes out. I will be all on that and binge watching the whole thing. I'm sure
I'm on the very last episode. I just started watching it a few weeks ago, and I'm on that last episode.
We watched Last Flag Flying.
Tulip.
Why do I keep doing that? Tulip. The next one. Ooh, this is a red band. Get ready for some sexy sex.
Sexual content.
Yeah, it's a little racy, guys.
I've decided to engage the services of a painter.
Put your brush to capturing my wife.
She's a rare beauty.
May I?
Don't move.
You've caught her beauty, sir. As well as her innocence and purity.
You've stolen my heart.
And you've stolen mine.
I could take you away.
He would find us. He would not stop looking for me unless I was dead.
Lord, I pray that my wife shall be not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible.
What is it?
I'm going to have a baby. If you throw me out, I'll tell your husband what you've been up to.
You've been busy. That's not painting.
First to flower, first to fall.
What's the matter?
She knows about us. What am I gonna do? I made a plan to save us both.
Are you mad?
You must trust me.
If we sink together.
There's nothing without risk.
What have I done?
Never underestimate God. He forgets nothing.
I must find her.
You two really think you'll carry this off?
We will be together.
I feel like they showed that, her looking weird like that earlier in the trailer.
They did.
I didn't love the trailer.
I have a huge girl crush on Alicia Vikander. I think she is so gorgeous and I will watch anything she's in just because I have a crush on her. So.
What about you guys? Watch,
naked,
or skip?
So.
I'll probably wait to see what the general consensus is.
Nothing really grabbed me about it.
I put a rent on it.
Yeah, maybe a rent. Yeah.
Did we show that on Twitch?
We just did, so whatever. It was very quick.
Quick.
Way too many scenes where they're holding each other or sex holding each other.
They did that a lot, apparently.
I don't know.
That's what an affair is supposed to be like. Lots of sex holding.
What is it that you do again?
Hunters.
So why don't you come hunt one for me then?
Hey, I like this cast. Ooh, more holding.
Why would a teenage sexual girl be out here? What is she running from?
You look at the clues, you're missing all the signs.
Yeah, it's got a good beat to it.
Down here you survive, or you surrender.
Wind River, rated R.
Huh.
I heard something on NPR. I heard an interview with one of the producers or writers of this movie, and it just sounded very interesting.
I believe it's Taylor Sheridan, the same guy who did Hell or High Water.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I guess it did kind of feel like that, the trailer. Mm.
Yeah, I think he's doing some really great stuff. They filmed Hell or High Water in New Mexico, and I got to meet him because my girlfriend was working at the production company that was compositing all of the footage.
Cool.
He's a really cool guy, and his process is really interesting. Like, he likes to edit his movies as they go. Mm-hmm. He doesn't just take all the footage and then edit.
Very cool.
Every time they film a scene, they'll edit it. And I don't know. Wow. He's very, he's an interesting person, and I like his directing style a lot. It's very, like, I don't know, there's something very honest about it.
Hmm.
I didn't love the trailer.
Yeah.
It reminded me of Tarzan.
Tarzan. Hmm. Like Snow Tarzan.
Snow Tarzan.
So Tarzan just, they start banging on a lot of drums in Tarzan.
Yeah, yeah, very rhythmic. Yeah.
I would rent it, I think.
But yeah, actually, think it reminded me a lot of the Mission Impossible. No. Not Mission Impossible.
Bourne
series.
Movies?
The Bourne 4? The fourth Bourne series where he's in
with
Snow?
Runner.
Okay. Now in Snow.
Yeah.
And it's not Matt Damon, and you're like, what?
What
happened to Matt Damon? He is
Wind River.
All
right, three more. Is that okay, Jess?
Well, it is 6:36, so one. I would say one.
Want to choose one more? Well, Strike or Strong Island?
What's Strike?
I will say I think one or both of these are new Netflix originals. Okay. I will say also American Horror Story. Apparently this newest season's about clowns riding off
and around
and off the back
of
it.
It's about like the election.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, it's not about clowns?
Let's watch the cult one.
Yeah,
let's.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
We can save the other ones till later.
Why do I think it's about clowns?
What's the thing that scares you the most?
Politicians are.
It is now official. Donald Trump is the next president of the United States.
Since election night, it has just all been getting so much worse.
The recurrence of the chlorophobia?
Yes.
The clowns.
I'll work through it.
He was right there!
Ellie, this is ridiculous!
I know what I saw!
What fills your heart with dread?
Children. I've always enjoyed children. Here, I got this for you. Just don't tell your moms.
I'm not making this up.
I don't know how much more of this I can take.
Get people scared enough, they will set the world on fire. It's the most intense physical pain you've ever experienced.
When I open this door, do not let go of my hand.
American Horror Story Cult premieres Tuesday, September 5th on FX.
Showing me. Huh.
Who's that guy? Who's that guy?
Evan something. He's the guy. He's basically done this.
Mm.
Oh, okay. He was in First Class, X-Men First Class. Mm. He played the fast guy. You know?
Oh,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's been in all the seasons of American Horror Story. Mm.
He's good. He's really good.
Yeah, I like him.
I think this is like the first season where he's a lead character. Mm. He's not just a side character.
Yeah, okay. That's awesome. Yeah.
Because they bring back some actors and not others, right?
Yep.
Yeah, I think depending on the season and who they need.
The pretty blonde lady who's the main character. I always forget her name. She's good. I like her. She's in all of the seasons.
I watched a little bit of season 3. Which one did I watch a little bit of?
The witches?
One
with the witches.
And I thought it was
Coven.
I thought it was very bad.
Yeah, I think the show's bad.
Okay.
Is that
in general,
the whole of it though? Like, is it's okay that it's bad? It's campy. You
my
know?
Impression of
it's campy.
What's his
I never
name?
Watched it.
David, the guy who creates all it, he also did. Oh my gosh, he's done a bunch of stuff. But
that's
like,
a good question, though. What's the pull of it?
I think
because people
start,
do watch it, like a lot of people.
There's typically like
it.
A good mystery and like mm-hmm. a good like, but then you have to start unveiling what the heck is actually going on, and then it seems like everything just breaks down into just nonsense.
Yeah,
okay. And like
that's
and
what it is.
It's 13 episodes and they're hour long episodes, so it just felt like it just feels like he's just pumping it full of like camp. And at the beginning of each season, it's like, oh, this is an interesting idea and an interesting concept. And then it's just like by the end, you're like, that was just like 13 hours of just like.
Mm.
So the
three
payoff
hours were good. Yeah,
the payoff isn't good.
No, well, I like the first season. I thought the first season was pretty good. It was really scary. Like it scared the crap out of me.
Yeah.
And then after that, it sort of got progressively worse, I think.
Hmm. What was the TV show about the people who did the plastic surgery that was out like?
Oh, Nip Tuck?
Nip Tuck.
That was his other thing that he did. And it was it's just all very like leather and sex and like, which is like cool, you know, if you like that stuff. But it just, it gets like, yeah, I would say there's almost like, it's almost like too indulgent at times.
Huh. I agree.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's a... It's a maybe a rent for me. Only because I thought the trailer was interesting enough.
I'm intrigued by the show just in general. Like, I would be interested in watching it, you know, just some of the seasons.
And the nice thing is you don't have to watch any other seasons to watch this.
Yeah.
Right.
Because they're
right.
all standalone
just, right.
seasons. They don't really connect.
So if this season gets good
You're gonna wait.
Ratings I'll watch.
Yeah. You're gonna wait. Okay, you?
Mm-hmm. Same. I'm gonna see like what. I'm really intrigued by the political aspect of it because I think that's like.
Yeah, that was like kind of in the beginning, and they didn't talk
like
about
the
it.
The satirical
rest of the time.
Aspect. Yeah. I really like that. I think it's really funny, but
that,
also
that
like
juxtaposition,
kind of horrifying because it is horrifying. I know we're not really supposed to say our opinions on politics, but
that's not true.
I will say that this administration is horrifying, so it's pretty realistic.
You heard it
depiction.
Here first.
Mm. Well, yeah. It sounds like they're definitely like exploiting that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Using it. Yeah. Definitely.
Very cool. Well, anyways, thanks for tuning into Screen Source Episode 2. Again, the show about film, television, news, reviews, and trailers. It's every Sunday at 3 p.m. MST on twitch.tv/colorcircuitlive. Like us, share, subscribe. We haven't done all the verbs in a while. We haven't
hashtag all the verbs.
We haven't even like pushed like, hey, maybe come back some like,
yeah,
I guess we see
yeah.
our schedule, but we haven't like, yeah, please like and follow us and all that stuff.
Yeah,
all that jazz.
Fun.
We're always posting stuff on Facebook and Instagram and all that stuff.
Twitter. And we will promise to pay more attention to some of the comments because there were, I saw one comment in here and I just like, we just weren't prepared. This was a crazy production day.
Yeah, getting stuff
a lot of
up
technical difficulties.
Yeah,
today,
yeah. One of our more technical.
We apologize for
shows,
that,
but anyways,
it was fun.
We have a swath of shows this upcoming week. I think 7 unique shows this week.
What?
I know. What? And then Jason, I want to talk to you about some more ideas. You had some ideas last night. You were talking to me about for Color Circuit, future of Color Circuit. Just some new shows.
Oh, I was just like throwing shit out of.
That's all I want. That's what I want from you. I want you to throw your shit at me. All
right, guys, we're gonna go watch Game of Thrones, and I hope you do too.
Yeah.
Have a good night.
Bye.